Hello and welcome to episode 19 of Caged In Presents Coppola Connections, brought to you by the Breadcrumbs Collective and hosted by me, Petros Patsilivas. And this week on the podcast, we are going back to school. Happens to be around the same time that schools go back to school, so call that kismet, baby, because the film we are talking about is Wes Anderson's 1998 coming-of-age comedy drama, Rushmore. And to join me for this conversation is David Trumble, a third-time return guest, but we'll get into that in due time. If this is your first time with the podcast, we watch every single film in the collective Coppola filmography to determine, are they the greatest film family of all time? We will obviously be talking about this film in all its gory details. There'll be spoilers aplenty. So if you haven't seen it, head on over to a handy document in the show notes that will tell you if and where this film is streaming. I'll give you a hint. It's Disney Plus. And as always, if you'd like to support the podcast, you can do so by heading over to patreon.com/cagedinpod. Or hit a link in the show notes that you can buy me a nice cup of coffee. So all that's left to do is to join as many clubs and societies as you can, befriend an old businessman, fall in love with your high school teacher, get kicked out as we head on over to Rushmore Academy and make some Coppola connections. ''98 was a busy year for the Coppola clan. Nick Cage was busy taking chances in Snake Eyes and City of Angels, and his then-wife Patricia Arquette was in both High-Low Country and Goodbye Lover. Jonathan Schwartzman was busy helping Michael Bay capture his world-saving oil crew in Armageddon, whilst his younger brother took his first steps into acting. The younger brother in question is Jason Schwartzman. And the focus of today's episode is Wes Anderson's coming-of-age comedy, Rushmore. To help me navigate the world of private schools, extracurricular activities, and forbidden love is animator, story artist, bombardment club founder, fencing team captain, kung fu yellow belt, and third-time return guest, David Trumble. How are you, David?
Hi. As always, it is a pleasure and privilege to be among the Petros Patsilivas players.
Yes, and today's performance will be a very small black box theater version of Rushmore.
But it'll be a hit play.
Of course, we're firing on all cylinders. We're doing it the Max Fischer way. No, all the stops are being pulled out for this.
Yeah, we've got a model train in the background. It's going to go past the window.
Well, before we get into talking about Rushmore too much, when did you first become aware of the Coppola family?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I was trying to trace my memory back, and it actually, I was aware, like the first Coppola family member I was aware of had to have been Nicolas Cage, but the first time I was aware that Coppola was a dynasty was, you know, conveniently enough, through Jason Schwartzman, in that I read an interview with him in Empire magazine shortly after, like, he blew up from Rushmore, and he was basically like making a running joke in his interview about dropping the names of all of his family members, like like they were hot. Like, so he was like, I was talking to my aunt, oh, that's, you know, this, and I was talking to my cousin, you know, Nicolas Cage, and my mother, you know, Talia Shire. Like, it was just really the first time that I was aware of, oh, okay, so not only is Francis Ford Coppola the director of Apocalypse Now and The Godfather, you know, none of those movies I had seen at that point, I think, or at least seen in their entirety. You know, it was the first time I realized that, oh right, so there are people in his orbit who, you know, if you are related to him, then that actually carries an awful lot of cachet in the film business. And yeah, so it was through Max Fischer himself.
Well, it's really interesting because Jason Schwartzman tells a story on David Letterman from 1999, kind of on like the press tour for this film, that it was at a party at Francis Ford Coppola's house that one of the casting agents for this film was there and kind of like said to him, like, you kind of look like a kid we're looking for this film Rushmore. Like, do you want to audition for it? Like, at least, so it's like already you've got that kind of like unknowing nepotism, and like there's a lot of knowing nepotism in the Coppola family. There's some unjustified, like people go like Sophia Coppola in The Godfather 3, I think, is like unjustified nepotism, because I think it was kind of like a fact of they were struggling, like all of, like, there was kind of tragedy beset that kind of like the casting of that, like one of the actresses had like a tragedy in her life, and then Winona Ryder pulled out at the last minute, and I think it was kind of like Francis Ford Coppola was like, Sophia, you do it. Like,
I mean, like, it actually feels weirdly human and understandable to think that after those setbacks, you would just go with somebody who you trusted, you know, irrespective of whether or not they were necessarily right for the role. You'd be like, well, I know Sophia. Sophia can handle the material or whatever. And it just feels like an unfortunate perfect storm of, like, everyone and their dog wanted the third Godfather movie, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's like, it was like a, it probably ended up being underwhelming in that sort of like Crystal Skull kind of like mentality of like, don't actually get what you want all the time, because it's not necessarily what you actually really need. So yeah, like I just feel sympathy for her, because she probably had to live that down for a very long time. But yeah, with Schwartzman, I don't necessarily think of it as nepotism, because of the fact that like they interviewed like thousands of people for that role. So the fact that he got it over those thousands of people doesn't necessarily feel like it was because he was a Coppola, because he doesn't even have the family name, you know, he's not even Jason Coppola. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how much it played into it, you know, but it is kind of funny considering, you know, obviously we're discussing Wes Anderson's movies. He's worked with Roman Coppola as well, on his scripts and things. And it's like, Wes Anderson is not married into the family, but he is as close as you can get to the family without being a Coppola. In my mind, like, it's like if this was Seinfeld, he'd be the Kramer who would just walk in to the apartment without a key and just help himself to something in the fridge. That's how I think of, he basically is a Coppola in anything but name, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and we'll get into it. Like, I think he kind of like knew the connection as well, because there's something hard baked into the script of this film that is like a reference to
there are one or two little doffs of the cap.
It's really interesting, you kind of say that thing that he is like an honorary Coppola, as it were. And it's and the thing with Roman, but like it was Jason who's the first Coppola to work with him. So obviously, like, he kind of Roman hadn't come onto his radar. And that, like, that casting of Jason Schwartzman, like you said, like, there were thousands of kids. And it's on the Moonrise Kingdom, like, commentary track, they say, like, that wasn't the kid that Owen Wilson and Wes Anderson had in mind. They kind of had this, like, image of this, like, Mick Jagger-looking kid, kind of scrawny, like, and then you got Jason Schwartzman.
Probably not a million miles away from what Wes Anderson looked like when he was 15, I'm sure.
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, Iggy Pop-style, Gollum-esque, you know, lithe figure. But it's so funny, because like Jason Schwartzman, I think my relationship to this movie is really specific. Mm-hmm. But it was obviously everybody's first introduction to him, you know, all told. And I think, regardless of whether or not any nepotism had anything to do with it, he's so fantastic in that role that consequently, even when I see him in like Scott Pilgrim versus the World, I never really think of him as anything other than Max Fischer. Like, he is Max Fischer for all time. Whenever I see him playing another part, I'm like, oh, it's Max Fischer being this guy. I still feel like I'm watching one of Max Fischer's plays, because he's just so indelible in that role. So,
well, what's wonderfully perfect about that kind of like life outside of the film and like the kind of Max Fischer character living on? I sent it to you a while ago, and anyone who's kind of listening, to seek out these amazing like MTV like stings they did for the MTV Music Movie Awards from 1999, that like is the Max Fischer players putting on some of the biggest films, like
That was really funny. I love that link. And it's funny how you mentioned that like they had a different look in mind for the character of Max, because if you look at, I just rewatched Bottle Rocket, which is Anderson's first movie that he made with Owen Wilson, and it was important for me to watch, because it was the only Wes Anderson movie I had yet to see. And it actually really informed my experience of this, because it was like the second movie, the second feature, the second album, kind of like taking all of the things you learned from that first scrappy entry. But the funny thing about watching it was that Luke Wilson is the main character, and Luke Wilson's haircut, that kind of slightly longer, sort of slightly curled bowl haircut that he has, is just 100% Wes Anderson's haircut. So I was just like, it reeked of that, like, he is, the hero is the filmmaker, just dramatized. You know what I mean? And so it makes perfect sense that their idea for Max Fischer would have been slightly different.
Well, there's like running themes throughout Wes Anderson films, and there's kind of things that inform the films beyond that that we'll get into in some like detail a bit further down the line. But it's like you kind of see things in Rushmore and you're like, oh, that's kind of like built upon then in The Royal Tenenbaums, and then it's like there's something else like in Rushmore that,
and then obviously there's the Jacques Cousteau connection of the fact that there's a book and documentary footage that you see of like underwater reefs and diving,
yes,
that obviously will be touched upon in Life Aquatic.
And then you have like the character of Max Fischer's father, who's played by Seymour Cassell.
He's so sweet in that film.
He plays the explorer that gets killed. He plays the guy who gets killed at the beginning of
Esteban.
Yeah, he plays Esteban at the beginning of
Esteban.
And it is that thing, like kind of there's the Max Fischer players. Like Wes Anderson is Max Fischer in a way, because like he's kind of built this repertory theatre of actors that he kind of uses over and over again.
100% are the Wes Anderson players.
Yeah.
You're in a Wes Anderson movie. It's almost like you've got an in for all time with his catalogue. Like, he'll put you in a tiny role even if you show up for like a second or in a voiceover. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like Harvey Keitel's entire filmography post, you know what I mean? Like a certain point is just showing up in Wes Anderson movies. Sure.
Yeah, and there's like I love the kind of like smaller characters who kind of like pop up from here and there. So there's the like groundskeeper in this film, who's got a he's got a fantastic name, which is like Mr. Little Jeans or something like that. Like, and then he turns up in the Royal Tenenbaums as Pagoda.
He's the guy who keeps stabbing Gene Hackman.
Yeah.
Out of some like weird sense of honor. I love it.
These are the names that define our world. The artists who shaped our minds. The rebels who challenged our views. But of all these legends, there is one that stands above all others.
I'm sorry, did someone say my name?
What's the secret, Max?
The secret? I think you just gotta find something you love to do and then do it for the rest of your life. For me, it's going to Rushmore.
Sharp little guy.
He's one of the worst students we've got.
We're putting you on what we call sudden death academic probation.
Could I see some documentation on that, please?
Did you invite that kid to your party?
Max Fischer.
Come on, Dad, there's gonna be girls there. I'd rather die.
Pull your head out of here.
Maybe I'm spending too much of my time starting up clubs and putting on plays.
It's time, homie.
Kiss me, little one.
I should probably be trying harder to score chicks.
I like your hat.
You're a teacher here, aren't you?
Oh, I'm so glad you could come.
I want you to meet a friend of mine, Peter Flynn, Max Fischer.
Hi. Who's this guy?
Has it ever crossed your mind that you're far too young for me?
I like your nurse's uniform, guy.
These are OR scrubs.
Oh, are they?
I don't know what you see in her. I don't think she's right for you.
What's that supposed to be?
Hello, Herman.
How are you, Rosemary?
I know about you and the teacher.
Does Max know? He's about 5'3", 112 pounds, glasses.
You know, you and Herman deserve each other. You're both little children.
War does funny things to men. Well, you'll find a pair of safety glasses and some earplugs underneath your seats. Please feel free to use them.
What do you think of Max's latest opus?
It's good, but let's hope it's got a happy ending.
Rushmore.
Thank you very much.
So is it fair to say that Rushmore would have been your first introduction to Jason Schwartzman?
Yes, and my first introduction to Wes Anderson, obviously. But it's weird. We're going to go into it in detail, but like this is when I agreed to do this pod about it. It was because Rushmore is my favorite Wes Anderson movie, and I had not watched it in many years because it was a very formative film of my teenage years. And I actually must confess, when I sat down to rewatch it for the pod, I had a lot of trepidation because I was worried. I didn't want it to have aged poorly or to have dated or to have become like, I don't know. Like, I was just worried that maybe my impression of it, because I felt so close to the characters and specifically my experience of growing up, you know, as reflected in the film, that like, I was worried, like, God, I really hope it's not like underwhelming when I watch it again. Like, I hope it's still my favorite. And I'm, you know, very pleasantly surprised to say that it is actually grown in my estimation. And that's really saying something, considering how truly beautiful Wes Anderson's films have become. Obviously, his style has become truly impeccable, you know. And so this is nothing against how like absolutely beautifully conceived and constructed his other movies are. But Rushmore just hits so many truthful beats to me that hit me on an emotional level. And so it's like, I'm very interested to talk about it because you know how the last few times I've been on with you, it's been me indirectly causing you to get emotional about being a dad. Like, it's basically just me starting to get you to cry every time. It's like, it's my turn. You know what I mean? This is a movie that has a huge emotional resonance with me because it speaks a lot to my teenage years. And like, you know, not to sound, you know, like I'm overly editorializing, but I feel a lot like a recovering Max Fischer myself, you know? And so it'll be very interesting to unburden myself with some stories and really dig into why this movie is so beautiful to me.
Well, to that point, I think what's fantastic about this and kind of many of Wes Anderson films, I think Moonrise Kingdom, as I spoke to Jeanette from Sudden Double Deep about, is that like, they kind of work on two different levels and like depending on like how old you are when you watch them. So like when you first watch Moonrise Kingdom, like for me, it was kind of like that thing. I was like, oh yeah, like I'm relating to this almost like remembering what it was like to be a kid. But then like watching it now, like, you know what I mean? 30 years old and like being a father, I'm like, oh, I'm very much watching this through the eyes of Bruce Willis, Bill Murray and Francis McDormand and even like Edward Norton. And I think it's that thing with Rushmore, like if it hits you at the age of 15, like the same age as Max Fischer, you're very much kind of aligned with the way he is and kind of like like the way whereas like as you get older you start to look at it through the Herman Bloom, like the Bill Murray character, and kind of like, because it is very much this tale of kind of one child wanting to be a man and one man wanting to recapture something from his youth.
Yeah, well, a lot of Wes Anderson's movies are about children trying desperately to be adults and adults acting like children. Everyone is a master of self-deception or in his stories. But I think what sets apart Moonrise Kingdom and Rushmore specifically to me is that they are the two films of his that I think feel the closest to real life. And I don't mean that to disparage the other movies, but the other movies are about very heightened things. So like Owen Wilson and Wes Anderson described Rushmore's reality as being a bit like, ironically for me, now that I'm working on Roald Dahl series at Netflix, like a Roald Dahl world, like something out of a book. And you know, obviously that gets more and more pronounced in Wes Anderson's films, all the way through to him directing Fantastic Mr. Fox, you know, which is a Roald Dahl book. But what's interesting about it is that even though his style is all the DNA of that stylized approach is there and present and fantastic in Rushmore, he still has a lot of handheld, and he's still graduating from Bottle Rocket, and consequently, it still feels like it's mostly taking place in the real world. Like Max Fischer himself is heightened and stylized, but there's an awful lot of times where he hits up against reality.
Yeah.
and jarringly and fantastically so. But I think what makes this movie and Moonrise Kingdom particularly powerful to me is that I just feel like they're more relatable to the audience as things that could have actually happened to you, in that, like, not everyone in the world is going to be a Tenenbaum, mm-hmm. and not everyone in the world is going to be an oceanographer like Steve Zissou. Like, those are elevated, heightened realities about people who are true prodigies, and, you know, like people who have like got narcissistic parents and like distant mothers, and not everyone has that experience. But I think everyone, or at least, you know, most people, most sensitive people who had a you know, who lived through their teens, has been Max Fischer at some point, or had a crush, mm-hmm. you know, that got out of control. I think it's the same with Moonrise Kingdom, because everyone can remember young love and being a kid and just like trying to be like an adult, even though you're nowhere close to being one. You know, I think that's why they're particularly believable to me.
Well, I think Rushmore is the last film that like Wes Anderson made before it departs into Wes Anderson land.
Like, yes, before he becomes similar to Kubrick. It's like, if you look at Paths of Glory,
yes,
you know, that is a movie that's like, you know, actually a really, really tightly paced movie. It's before he becomes super indulgent. And like, I think this movie, Rushmore, is under 90 minutes if you don't include the credits, you know. So it's like brevity is also present, because he's just figuring out his style and stuff. But, you know, then it becomes this massive, like, you can tell the next movie he's making that's about to come out, you know, once the pandemic lifts, is going to be massive. You know, just the scope of it, the scale of it, the cast, it's probably incredibly long, you know, because he's grown accustomed to being able to have latitude with the audience. But it is interesting to watch these early movies, especially this one, where there's just no fat on it. It's a perfectly paced, structured story, you know.
So do you mind telling us a brief synopsis of this film? But for anyone who out there may not have seen it, I don't know why you're listening to this podcast, but could you give us a brief synopsis?
So the plot of Rushmore, it's so simple. It's just a story about this kid, Max Fischer. He's the son of a barber, comes from humble beginnings, but he wrote a little one-act play about Watergate when he was a kid, because he's a precocious writer, if nothing else. And his mother, who's now dearly departed, loved his play so much that she submitted it to this private school, Rushmore Academy. And so he was like a moonshot, you know, working class student who got in. And so the story begins with Max excelling in all these extracurricular activities at Rushmore, because he's trying so desperately to be something that he isn't. He's trying to be this brilliant genius academic. And yet, it's revealed that he's one of their worst students and is failing miserably in all of the tests and essays and papers that actually require a correct answer, you know, that actually, you know, like, he's actually not as bright as he thinks he is or says he is. And so the film is all about him. His entire life in Rushmore, like, is thrown into jeopardy when he develops an infatuation with a teacher called Miss Cross, played by Olivia Williams. And that brings him into conflict with everyone else, including the school, including his friend Herman Bloom, played by Bill Murray. And the story charts this absolutely just like perfect infatuation stages story, where it charts every single stage of first love, of becoming hyperbolically obsessed, and then being shot down and losing it all and realizing that you have to build yourself up out of something true as opposed to something imagined. And so it's a story of coming of age, but done in Wes Anderson's, you know, trademark persnickety style. And it's just glorious.
It's really interesting that they got Jason Schwartzman for the lead in this, for one. Mm. You mentioned about like the playwriting. Obviously, it's like a key like thing throughout this film, is that like, Francis Ford Coppola, when the kind of Coppola children were young, during like summer holidays and stuff like that, would set them a task of like writing a one-act play. And because he kind of had this like grand estate in the Napa Valley, would get them to like go, right, you got 3 days, you got a couple of days to kind of like get your play written, and then we're going to perform it. We've got like a kind of theater set up.
That sounds simultaneously awesome and terrifying. Like, can you imagine being a kid having a panic attack because you're like the least writing inclined Coppola.
But then, like, so Jason Schwartzman, like, it's one of the many interviews I've listened to. He, like, it's mentioned that he kind of wrote this one act, like, Tennessee Williams inspired play. So, like, he has that element of a Max Fischer very much inside of him.
But there's a, like, there's an interesting metatextual irony of the fact that he's probably more in real life a Tenenbaum than he is a Fischer. You know, like, he actually doesn't come from a barber's shop. Mm-hmm. You know, like, he's someone who's a legacy artist, and so that's an interesting, like, dynamic, because he is perfect for this role of Max, yet his experience in real life is probably much more. Is it Margot Tenenbaum, played by Gwyneth Paltrow, who actually is an exceptional playwright?
Yes, yeah.
The adopted daughter of Gene Hackman in that film. Like, weirdly, I wonder if Wes Anderson actually gleaned anything from his experience with Schwartzman for that movie, because, you know, that's probably more what it must be like to be in the Coppola family, is the Tenenbaums.
Well, there's, like, this is probably the only chance I'll get to say it on the podcast, but Jason Schwartzman was supposed to be the character Mordecai in the Royal Tenenbaums, which was, like, written as an actual character instead of a falcon. But, like, I think because there was too many moving parts in that film, because you've kind of got that, like, all-star cast, and kind of everyone's got their individual threads and stuff like that. They were kind of like, we haven't got time for another thread, and kind of dropped him. And it's very interesting as well, because there's a lot of speculation online. So there's a scene of one of Richie's tennis matches in the Royal Tenenbaum. Mm. And the commentator sounds exactly like Jason Schwartzman. And it's been revealed that it's actually Wes Anderson, which kind of makes me think that, like, as much as there is that thing that you mentioned earlier of, like, Wes Anderson being, like, a kind of surrogate Coppola, it's almost, like, very much... Because around this time as well, like, Jason Schwartzman, like, would have lost his father, Jack. So, like, it's almost like Wes Anderson took him under his wing, and, like, kind of like Jason Schwartzman's, like, affectation, the way he speaks, like, even in interviews, kind of, like, feels like it's born out of this kind of relationship he's developed with Wes Anderson, which I think is, like, wholly fascinating. But
And it definitely speaks to the themes of all of Wes Anderson's movies, which is, like, people trying to paper over big voids in themselves, like absences, an absent parent or an absent child. Like, even Bill Murray in Rushmore, playing Bloom, he has two sons who he actually can't stand, who he has no connection with whatsoever. He doesn't even understand them, and yet he likes Max. And weirdly, Max is actually has more in common with Bloom than any other character, because Bloom is clearly, like, a self-made man, and Max is a barber shop son. You know, like, it's funny, because, like, Max is impressing Bloom, and Bloom even offers for him to come work for him. He actually gives him, like, a golden opportunity, and Max passes it up because Max does not want to be anything other than this Rushmore, you know, Yankee. And so it's like Max is constantly being offered these opportunities to be who he really could be, as opposed to what he thinks he should be. But it is fascinating to see that, like, there are these themes of fathers and sons and sisters and daughters and mothers all throughout Wes Anderson's films. But it seems to definitely, I think you're right. I think there are elements of that in real life with Anderson, clearly. Yeah. He clearly understands those dynamics.
Yeah, I think there is, like, a kind of, like, 10-part podcast series called, like, Wes, Are You Okay With Your Dad? Like, in that, like, all of his films kind of have this, like, thing of people, either whether it's, like, looking for their actual dads, or, like, kind of looking for these surrogates for father
figures. I just want to see a freaking support group with Anderson, Noah Baumbach, and Steven Spielberg is the leader of it. Like, he's running the table. and who else? Oh, Taika Waititi would also be a great addition. Like, they all make movies about their fathers.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. It's almost like a kind of, like, live action scene of that Wreck-It Ralph, kind of, like, like, meeting up of all of the, like, villains. Like,
I just want to see Steven Spielberg clutching Wes Anderson as he weeps, saying, "It's not your fault." It's not your fault, Wes.
As he adjusts his cap, is like is
exactly
his sunbeaten dad cap going like it's okay. Yeah, and I guess we're gonna see the kind of the gestation and the amalgamation of Steven Spielberg's daddy issues in a film where he's actually. Shout outs to our boys.
Is Paul Dano okay? Yeah, portrayed by the legendary Paul Dano.
Yeah, is going to play Steven Spielberg's dad. Like, yeah. But back to Rushmore, and like, I think the opening scene to this film really just kind of like perfectly paints the picture of who Max Fischer is. That kind of like, yeah. we open with that like daydream of him. Mm. Solving that maths equation.
And who hasn't had a daydream like that?
Exactly.
Yeah. Like, who hasn't imagined being way smarter? Or with me and my brother, I think we both agree, it's our daydreams is that we can sing, mm-hmm. you know, that we have a beautiful singing voice or can play an instrument. But yeah, with Max, it's that he solves this impossible equation.
And the way it's done as well, where it's like, but it's not just the fact of, like, he solves the equation. It's more to the fact that he is, like, the bell of the ball in the school, that he has the kind of like utmost
constantly holding a cup of tea in his hand while he's doing it and shit, and like just like he's in this amazing blazer that he wears throughout, which is like his costume, like his superhero costume. He wears it even when he's not, even after he's been kicked out of Rushmore, he wears that blazer like it's his superhero suit, like he's trying to actualize himself through this sort of symbol of what it is that he's meant to be, which is what he is in his fantasies, obviously, which is like some brilliant genius, the cult of the great man. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, even the way he directs his plays is obviously he's had internalized into him from just like seeing how great men across history who are creators, directors, writers, playwrights treat their staff and treat their actors. You know, like he's basically playing a role the whole way through, because I mean it's really cool to me, as someone who you know clung to the fact that he was a good drawer all the way through school, and you know often used that as a way to overcome his you know seeming deficits for like you know not having a girlfriend or not being particularly popular or whatever, like you know trying to overcome the bubble I had been in of being a twin brother, which meant that I was in like a world of my own for a long time. Suddenly you become a teenager and it's like, oh God, I need to do something to stand out against this crowd. Not only to stand out against the other students, but to stand out against the person who looks exactly like me. You know what I mean? Like, I'm, I actually relate an awful lot to Max Fischer because Wes Anderson is a genius at writing people who are basically like, they are the stars of their own self-written stories.
Yes.
You know, and that's all teenagers in a nutshell. Like, you might not be like Max Fischer, but everyone when they're about 15 is writing a narrative for themselves and trying to present that to the world as fact. And they think that if they present that exterior, that will then just become true. That, like, if people believe you enough, then you will become that person. And it's built on all this insecurity. And I certainly had that same thing. I didn't wear a blazer like Max Fischer does, but I wore all black and I emoed up. I got a goatee beard, like which just looked like a tiny caterpillar on my chin. And it was just like I basically spent the last 2 years of my high school life drawing a graphic novel in recess and in lessons even. Like it would be confiscated all the time. And it was like my way of doing something of value, which was I had to create a work, a piece, something that had my name on it. And it actually won a prize in the school for creativity. And it was like my one act play. It was like my one act Watergate play. And it got published as a graphic novel in bookstores, but it obviously didn't make any money because it's a graphic novel about nothing. Like it was a 265 pages that me and only like a handful of people ever read. But for me at the time, it was such a huge deal because it was all I had in my mind, you know. And what's funny is looking back on like the man I was then, like, you know, or the boy trying to be a man, you know, an awful lot of that I have in common with Max, which is just, he thinks that he needs to be important so badly. Mm-hmm. So much so that he tells Bloom that his father is a brain surgeon, you know, that he basically lies about everything. And one thing I think is that I didn't notice the first time I watched the movie, but I did notice now, is there's actually a really lovely theme about everyone in the story who's young, at least, is lying, even the people who aren't like Max. So it's like, we meet her later, like Margaret Yang, when he goes to the public school, you find out that she actually faked the results to her, you know, prize-winning science project that she did because she wanted to hit some standard that was imagined. And then even the bully, is it Buchan? Yeah. The Scottish bully who keeps being totally horrible to him all the way through. It's revealed at the end that, like, one of the reasons why he picks on him is he just always wanted to be in one of his plays.
Yeah.
And you know, like, everyone's got, like, this front that they're trying to live up to. And none of them can, because you just can't do that. That's just, like... But I think that's one of the reasons why it's such a believable film compared to Anderson's other work, because in all of Anderson's other movies, people are lying to themselves. Mm-hmm. People are deluded. But Max is one of the only Wes Anderson characters who is at the exact right age where it's 100% appropriate that he's lying.
Yeah.
Because everyone fucking did. You know, like that was me when I was a kid. I was just constantly walking around trying to sound smart, trying to sound academic. And I grew up in Oxford, and Oxford was a real great university town. And I had an awful lot of like impressions of feeling like I had to be brilliant in order to matter. And that's just a ridiculous feeling. And the sooner you dispense with that, the sooner you can get on with some life of actual substance.
Well, yeah, your thing to the point of like lying, even we get it with Mason Gamble's character, Dirk Galloway, where it's like, you get that thing where like he even comes to Max later on in the film for like a truce. But even that is like kind of, there's an underlying deception to that, because it's for him to relay a message for him to go see Guggenheim in the hospital. And then we kind of realize that was all a ploy, so him and Bloom would like kind of reconnect after this kind of big like breaking up of their friendship.
I find Calloway so funny. He's got some of the funniest moments in the story, despite the fact he's just a little kid. And there's that moment when Miss Cross, who I can't believe we haven't even mentioned yet, but we'll get to her. But like Miss Cross and Bloom are starting their relationship, and then they go for a walk. And it's one of the most perfect sound cues in all of film, where it just hard cuts, you know, like smash cuts to Calloway seeing them, and this organ music just goes. it's the comedy equivalent of a jump scare. It's so fucking good. And every time Calloway's on screen, he takes everything so seriously that it's just like, it's just hilarious. And his relationship with Max is brilliant.
Well, it's that thing is, the thing about like the Dirk Calloway character is, well, one, he's played by Mason Gamble, who was Dennis in Dennis the Menace from 1993.
Hey, Mr.
Really?
So do you remember the kind of Dennis the Menace with Christopher Lloyd?
I do remember it. Yeah. I watched it once. It was a very weird experience.
Yeah. So like, and Wes Anderson said he basically didn't want the kid who was Dennis the Menace. Do you know what I mean? Like, I think that's the kind of like snobbery of Wes Anderson coming through. Where it's like,
a little elitist. Yes.
Yeah. I don't want that kid. But he
doesn't completely escape from the trappings of his characters. That's for sure.
But he is. Like, he is fantastic. And, like, looking through his IMDb, hasn't really done much else. Like,
yeah.
Which is
he didn't want to.
Like, yeah. Which is a real shame because, like, the character of Dirk is really interesting. And, like, there's somebody else who's really interesting. And they're not named at all in the script. But there is a character of, like, a small boy who just, I'm not sure if you picked up on this, who crops up throughout the films.
He's just there. He's got like big eyes.
Yeah, so
he always looks a little miserable.
He's the boy who like when Bloom has that like really like, it's a really great moment in the film, like set to a Kink song, where Hal Bloom's throwing Herman Bloom's throwing like balls into the pool, and then like gets up and then like dives off the diving board.
Yeah,
and he's the kid under the water, and like, if you notice,
he's like the Greek chorus of the film.
Yeah, that little boy kind of like pops up all the way through, and like his kind of facial expressions almost like tell you like, oh, like he's always like listening in to everything that's
going
on.
Isn't he in the he's in the party after the show at the very end, next to all the nudie girl pictures that are just like really inappropriately put up in the set dressing to make it look like Vietnam. He looks like he's so traumatized.
He's everywhere. There's even a moment when, like, the police turn up to Bloom's, like, door and are asking for, like, the description. That kid's just
oval
there.
Oval face.
That kid's just on the doorstep as well. And he's
just there. You don't know his relationship to anybody. He could be in Mrs. Cross's class, maybe. I don't think so. He's just there. He's just a hanger-on.
Yeah. And it's
very interesting.
I find that really fascinating. But obviously, yeah, once we get that kind of, like, when Max snaps out of that daydream and we get that introduction from Bloom telling that kind of, he's gone off script, basically, of what he'd written. Mm.
Yeah.
And I think it perfectly plays into what you were saying earlier, where it's like, he is a made man, because he's kind of like giving this speech, which is all about, like, the privilege of these kids. And like, you should keep the rich ones in your crosshairs. Like, they're the,
take them down.
And a great bit of trivia is that is based on an actual speech that Owen and Luke Wilson's father, like, gave. And like, the character of Bloom, like, a lot of like the kind of lines that he says. I think there's a line later on in the film where he's like, "How did I end up with, like, boys like you?"
Yeah,
is directly lifted from Richard Wilson, I think his name is.
Like, that's so interesting. Well, I mean, like, that touches on something that I'm really glad you brought up, which is that, you know, obviously Wes Anderson gets an awful lot of press for this film, but, you know, it's easy to forget that the script was co-written by Owen Wilson. Mm-hmm. You know, that Owen Wilson, you know, despite also being a very likable star, you know, has a very good talent, and, you know, the script for the Royal Tenenbaums is just as amazing. And, you know, these guys collaborated, and there must be an awful lot of Owen Wilson's life in this story, as well as just Anderson, who obviously brings all of the visual pizzazz and an awful lot of the personality. But, you know, it's nothing without that combination of the two.
Well, yeah, you can kind of see it in that, like, that there's that frustrated dad who, like, for obviously, like, Wes Anderson aesthetic's sake, he's just given him twin sons, whereas, like, Owen Wilson's real life would have been three boys, because there's the other brother as well. But it's like, yeah, you very much get that sense of, like, they're drawing upon that. I think it's very much, like, drawn upon Wes Anderson and Owen Wilson's childhoods. You see, like, the film is even filmed at St. John's, which is Wes Anderson's old school, because apparently they were looking, like, globally, they were looking in America, Canada, and the UK for schools, essentially, they could film at. And Wes Anderson's mum said to him, like, "Well, why don't you go to your old school? It would be perfect for this story you're telling," which even that point tells you how kind of, like, this is personal. Do you know what I mean? You can very much, like, see Wes Anderson's mentioned, I think he's on this Charlie Rose interview, that he used to put on plays at school, and he even tried to mount a version of Star Wars. So, like, very much with the same ambition as Max Fischer, where he's trying to, like, do these kind of, like, cinematic films.
I'm sure if he could have, you know, put pyrotechnics all over the stage, he would have, right?
Yeah. Or it's like, I'm sure if he could have, he would have done Serpico as well. Like,
exactly.
So shall we quickly talk about, so we get this amazing, like, kind of introduction, like, and there's great storytelling in this film that you kind of get to know Max through that amazing opening with the daydream. And then that kind of, I think it's Bloom's talking to Guggenheim about Max, and he says, like, "Oh, who is it?" He's like, "He's the worst student we've ever had." And then we get that, like, montage of all the things that Max does.
Yeah, the things he does to make up for the fact that he's a terrible student.
So I've got them listed here. So he's the Yankee Review publisher, French club president, UN model, Russia, stamp and coin club vice president, debate team captain, lacrosse team manager, calligraphy club president, astronomy club founder, fencing team captain, track and field, JV decathlon, second choral choir master, bombardment society founder, kung fu club yellow belt, trap and skeet club founder, Rushmore beekeepers president, Yankee racers founder, Max Fischer's players director, and the Piper Cub club 4.5 hours logged.
I think the saddest shot of that whole montage is the running track. and it's just him running. He's just completely alone. There's no one else on his team. That just makes me so sad for him. It's a great montage. It's probably one of the most iconic shots in the movie is him in the car,
yeah,
with the big goggles. Apparently that's modeled on a classic photograph. But it's like, yeah, it sets up everything. I mean, those two sequences do an awful lot to tell you what Max Fischer is trying to be.
Mm-hmm.
That the whole first half of the movie is about deconstructing the man that he wants to be, and then the last half is about him becoming the person he actually is.
He then finds out that obviously he's got to be expelled, and then finds that book that is he finds out who checked in this book.
Yeah, he sees the
an inscription, right?
An inscription that she wrote in the margins of a Jacques Cousteau book. That's obviously thinking about her husband, I guess, who drowned, and it's it leads him to her, and that's when we meet Olivia Williams,
who is fantastic for a character who is basically just the object of affection for two characters. She does really well with what she's got, essentially. Do you know what I mean?
I 100% agree. One of the things I was so struck by in this film on this rewatch was just how hard of a line she has to walk the whole way through the film, because she basically she's basically a conglomeration of what must have been the first love of both Owen Wilson and Wes Anderson, and a stand-in for every member of the audience's first crush as well. And so that's a massive, massive cipher, essentially, that she has to be whilst also being a real character.
Mm-hmm.
And she has to walk this line of seeming she has to walk the line of clearly seeing something in Max, clearly liking him, clearly caring for him. And actually, they have some kind of chemistry that is deep and personal. You see it in her face a lot of the time, that she sees things in him that remind him of her late husband. But at the same time, she has to do it in a way that is never unseemly, and in a way that feels like she's always being appropriate. And so one of my big fears when I was going to rewatch the movie was God, I really hope this movie actually isn't a movie that I thought was brilliant at the time, but actually, did the disservice to the female characters. And I was very relieved when I saw some of Williams's scenes, in the context of now being older and wiser. I was like, holy shit, she knows exactly how to deal with this little squirt. She basically she shuts him down really early when she notices that he's interested. She says all the right things. She's super gentle with him. And then when he starts pushing his luck, she really shuts him down in firm ways that are still kind. And it's like I wish, that every person who people get infatuated with reacted as gracefully as she does. But I think it culminates in one of the most important sequences, which is just brutal, which is the scene midway through the film, after he's been expelled and after he's tried to get her expelled and she's resigned because of the pressure of him basically hounding her, and he tries to kiss her. Mm-hmm. Which is oh my god, what a problematic thing to do, what a dicey thing to do. And the movie goes there and it's perfect, because she literally throws him across the room into some boxes and then calls him on all of his bullshit. Because basically, when you think about infatuation, I say earlier that we're all the writers of our own narratives when we're young, even when we're adults, but maybe with a bit more perspective. And Max is always hilariously borrowing from films and plays and books and TV that he knows. Mm-hmm. So it's when he first meets her, he lights her cigarette because it must have been something he sees people do in plays. He sees, urbane, witty, charming people do that. So that's what he does. And then, you get this feeling that Max smokes all the way through, but you get the feeling Max doesn't even like cigarettes, but it's just something he thinks he has to do to be sophisticated. And then even when he goes to war with Bloom, when he finds out Bloom is now dating Miss Cross, he shows up in the back of his car in shadow, because that's what would happen in a noir. And everything he says is written in his own head for. You can tell that he rehearsed everything he was going to say. Yes. You can tell that he's dramatized every single detail of his suffering because that's the way he feels he has control over it. And it's hilarious, but it's also like cringe-worthingly embarrassing because it made me think about times when I've dramatized things in my head when I was a kid. Because when you fall in love, everything is hyperbolic and you start to sort of like cast yourself as the victim. And then when he tries to kiss her, it's hilarious because it basically proves the saddest thing about having a crush when you're young, which is that in your mind, you plan everything, you write everything, including what the other person is going to do in your head.
Yeah.
Of like, here's how I'm going to get it. And then I'm going to kiss her. And then the funniest thing is that he has nothing after that point in his head. He has no idea what to do once he tries and fails. Like the moment she literally says, oh, fuck no, get away from me. He's completely blindsided. And it just brings home how completely unprepared he is for life. Mm-hmm. And then she basically says, what do you think is going to happen if we did get them? Do you think we're going to have sex? Like, and he says, well, that's kind of like a crude way to put it. And she said, well, not if you've ever fucked, it isn't. And like, she just like says, you know, flat out, you're a boy. She puts him in his place. And clearly he's just terrified by this because it's like when you're a kid and a teenager and you fall in love with people, you fall in love at them. And it's like the Joker, like the dog chasing cars, like he wouldn't know what to do with her if he caught her.
Yeah.
And so that scene is so brilliant and so fantastic at like walking that really dicey line. And I think a lot of it is down to Williams because she takes that character that could just be, like you say, the vessel for everyone's desires. And she makes a real character out of it. And even towards the end, when, you know, like there's this whole ridiculous plotline of Max and then Bloom creating an aquarium for her, you know, out of love, like to prove their devotion to her. And she, you know, says in like the simplest, calmest way, like, you know, I never actually asked anyone to build me an aquarium.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you realize that your infatuation with me is entirely to do with you. It's not really to do with me, you know? And yeah. It's a shame because you can tell that she really does care for Max, you know.
What's really interesting about that as well is you kind of like at that point you've realized like how kind of Bloom almost looks up to Max as well, like in the fact that like they are almost equals in this film, whereas like one of them is on like the precipice of adulthood and one of them is kind of like been round the block a few times and just kind of wants to be back at the stage that Max is. And I think, like, Owen Wilson says it on the commentary, that when that kind of scene on the diving board is Bill Murray's character's once-in-a-lifetime moment, that kind of, like, this is not my beautiful house, this is not my beautiful wife. Like, it's like he's kind of realizing, like, what the fuck am I doing here? Like, clearly my wife doesn't love me, like she's like flirting with the tennis coach and like his kids fucking hate him, like,
and he doesn't relate to them in any way. Like the reason he likes Max so much is that that's what he thinks his child, who was born into privilege, that he is now, he's a millionaire, he's had children born into privilege and therefore they have none of the get up and go that he had when he was young. So Max actually fits that mold so much better. So he just sees these Neanderthals that he's raised, that he's sired, just living up in this life of utter privilege and obliviousness, you know, then, you know, clearly cruel and bullyish. And I believe Bill Murray himself disliked the actors of the two boys who played his sons. So a lot of his microaggressions or overt aggressions towards them are just Bill Murray being like, I fucking hate these guys. But this is a good opportunity to talk about Bill Murray, because this was the first movie of his I watched that put him back on the map for me, after like obviously he's in Ghostbusters, he's this, he's that, and it's like, you know, Groundhog Day. But this is probably, I looked back at his IMDb and it's like, this is before Lost in Translation, before he works with another Coppola, of course. You know, he's got Coppola connections abound, but it's like, this is like the beginning of the Renaissance.
Yes,
you know, his first big role in an indie that set him apart from being like, oh, he's a washed up guy. Because like, what had he done you know, the year before or so, like what, Wild Things? Like, he's the best thing in Wild Things. That's the best you could say about it. Exactly. Like, it's like, but this is the beginning of him re-legitimizing himself.
Yeah, the 90s, he's kind of got that weird thing where he's saying, like, what about Bob? He's doing that film with the elephant in it. He's doing that Osmosis Jones and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But, like, he really, like, took to the script of this. And there's this great anecdote that he tells about, like, He read the script and he was like, I love it. And they're like, oh yeah, we'll send you Bottle Rocket. And then like, he's like, yeah, send it to me. Like, send him over a copy of Bottle Rocket. Then he speaks to Wes. He's like, I want to do the film. And he's like, I want to do it. Like, I'll even take no paycheck. This film, like, that's how much Bill Murray loved.
And wasn't Wes Anderson like really reverent the first time they were filming together? Like, he almost like was afraid to direct him because he looms so large in his estimation. Obviously, there's a little bit of the Max Fischer hero worshipping from Wes Anderson towards Bill Murray.
Yeah, and there's that thing as well that I think, like, Bill Murray, like, as much as he's kind of seen as this, like, I don't know, almost like jovial uncle of like cinema, and like you hear all these great stories about him. Like, he does have a mean streak to him, and there are these kind of Hollywood stories of him, like, not liking what people are doing, and kind of like, I don't know, like, I think, yeah, he's like, he threw someone in a lake in, like, do you know what I mean, whilst filming and stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, like, Bill Murray has darkness in him, and that is obviously a vein that Anderson taps over and over again in his movies with Murray, which is that Murray, this is, you know, not only is it the beginning of the Renaissance, it's the beginning of Bill Murray is the sad sack, the sad clown, because he was just a clown before. He really wasn't. He was, you know, at best in Groundhog Day, he was like a Scrooge. And then in Scrooge, he was Scrooge for real. But like, he was like a guy who was cynical and sort of like abrasive. Whereas once he hits this sort of middle age period, suddenly he becomes this character. His face is etched with regret. You know, there's that amazing sequence which is just followed on from probably my favorite moment in the whole film, which is the kite flying scene. But like, the kite flying scene has that incredible needle drop of, you know, you asked online the other day, what's the best needle drop in the movie? For me personally, there's like I actually just rebought the soundtrack because it's like, it's so good. Yeah. I just found myself listening to it all day yesterday. But the best needle drop for me is the song that introduced me to Cat Stevens as a teenager, which was The Wind, you know.
Yeah.
I listen to the wind of my soul. It's such a simple song. Yeah. It's only like two verses long, but it's so beautiful. So perfect for that moment of Max finally reawakening after having lost all sense of his identity. You know, when he starts listing names for the Kite Flying Society. Mm-hmm. But then it goes from this incredible moment of Max having an epiphany to a hard cut to Murray's face. Murray just standing on the side of the road outside the barbershop. A car goes by and spritzes him with like dirty water, and he doesn't even care. He doesn't even notice almost. He looks utterly bereft. And so this was like the first time I sat up and took Murray seriously as someone who could do really dramatic acting, because, you know, Rushmore is ostensibly a comedy, but there's a great deal of tragedy to Bill Murray's character. Like, just, he looks so lost in that moment.
He's like it's one of the things I'm saying, like, it's kind of like knock-on effect to Wes Anderson's like next films. He's like, he's almost like a prototype for a Royal Tenenbaum. Like, you've got this guy who's kind of estranged from his family, living in a hotel, who like at the beginning of the Royal Tenenbaums is how we meet Gene Hackman's character. And but like, he's got a lot more heart to him, whereas like Royal Tenenbaum is very much like kind of
conniving, I still feel like this is his best Anderson movie. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, not that he's bad in the other Anderson movies, but he becomes a bit more like part of the wallpaper in other Anderson movies because he's just Bill Murray being another Bill Murray.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's like he essays the sad sack now over and over again in Wes Anderson's movies. You know. I mean, I think, you know, Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou, he gets to take center stage, of course. But Life Aquatic is actually probably lower down on the list for me of Wes Anderson movies because it's so stylized. Mm-hmm. It was like, it was the first time Wes Anderson went full tilt into his own style. But Murray often plays like a loser, like who's going to go cut down a tree out of frustration in Moonrise Kingdom. Whereas this, he has so much more to play with as Bloom. He's a little bit closer to past Bill Murray. He's like right on the handoff between those two sides of himself. So he still has a bit of edge to him in this, like that incredible montage of them trying to sabotage each other after yeah. Max puts bees into his hotel room. And you just see this moment where Murray sees the bees being funneled into the room, and he it's so good because he smiles at it almost like he's impressed.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then his face hardens back into malevolence, and it's such a great, like, a nemesis moment that you just wouldn't see any other Bill Murray from any other of Anderson's movies doing.
But then you get that, like,
maybe the badger.
Yeah, you get that great, like, moment later on where they've kind of, like, reconciled their differences after the moment you talk about, where he's kind of like all disheveled and that. And what's really interesting that is he's wearing like the exact same outfit as when we saw him last in the hospital, where he's like, it's I think now it's like, yeah, kind of when you Google Rushmore, it's one of the first images that popped up of those two in the lift. You got Bill Murray with two cigarettes in his mouth, and he's just those beautiful little details of kind of like how, I don't know, how disheveled and how off the rails his life has got. Like, he's hiding miniature bottles of booze underneath blankets in a hospital.
And you could tell a lot of it is like Murray improvising as well. Like, he's such a gifted improviser. Like, there's that bit where he realizes Miss Cross isn't coming to the groundbreaking of the aquarium that he spent $8 million on, and he's just, I gotta get out of here. And he walks through the marching band and he just says, scatter, scatter, scatter. And it feels like a Murray ad lib to me. Like, it just feels like something he would say.
Well, one of the amazing things about Bill Murray, he said, like, a lot of the time when he reads scripts, he reads them under the guise of, like, what do I need to do to make this character better? Do you know what I mean? Like, and he said there's only like a few scripts in his career. I think it's Groundhog.
Perhaps he's like on the other side of the spectrum to Nicolas Cage, whereas Nicolas Cage is like, is it a script? I'll do it!
Yeah, well, he's like, kind of like, he looks at the script and he's like, yeah, the story's good. Or it's like, what kind of, like, what can I basically do to write?
Yeah.
Like, what have I got to write to make this, like, better? Whereas, like, I think the reason he kind of took Rushmore was he just saw the script and he went, I've hardly got to do anything with this, because it's...
Do you know what? It must be a mark of considerable pride to be a director who manages to land Murray for a role. Like, it must be like catching the white whale, you know what I mean? It's like Wes Anderson, Sofia Coppola, and the guy who did Garfield, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Maybe he doesn't get invited to the party.
Yeah, but, they've all bagged the Jaguar shark that is exactly. Bill Murray.
The Jaguar shark! That's so good! I mean, like, it must be amazing to know that's one of your players. You know what I mean? That you could just play him like a baseball card almost whenever you need him. Yeah. He's like the Michael Caine for a Nolan movie.
One of the things I wanted to talk about in this film, David, was the fact that, like, watching it now, Max Fischer can, like, what kind of is like an unlikable character, right? Like, he very much like portrays himself to be that way. And it's like, it's a bold move for a film, especially like a second director. Like, I guess it's Wes Anderson's like actual title. Do you know what I mean? He's kind of like caught the interest of a lot of like filmmakers, especially. I know that it was Bottle Rocket that made Michael Bay cast Owen Wilson in Armageddon and stuff like that. So, like, it got like, yeah, this is the first time he can kind of really go, well, with a bit more of a budget, this is what I can do. And then he kind of like gives us, well, here's this, our lead character is wholly unlikable for most
of
the film.
Is the antagonist for most of his own story. Yeah, I mean, like, I guess that's where casting becomes so important, because it is entirely down to the charm of Jason Schwartzman that we don't hate Max. That, like, that even though we can see that he is objectively in the wrong for most of the film, we understand why he's doing it, because he makes it so crystal clear on his face that he's just a boy who's scared and wants to prove himself and has this idea of himself that he has to live up to. But you hit upon something that I knew I was going to talk about and that I was really excited to talk about, but it really cuts deep to why I feel a lot of connection to this film, which is that one of my trepidations about revisiting it was that, like, you know, when you watch movies when you were young and then you realize that, like, essentially, there were all of these messages that you received through media, through films, through television, these pernicious messages that sort of fed what has now become incel culture.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Max Fischer displays a lot of, you know, for want of a better phrase, like incel-like mindsets and behaviors, because he is the embodiment of a white cisgendered man going through his first crush in a world where obviously all of his heroes are great men. You know, they're directors, they're auteurs, and women are not, you know, presented to you as people, but as objects of desire, as a role that you've cast them in. And it's kind of hilarious because he goes through the movie, even Luke Wilson's cameo as her surgeon friend, when he shows up in the OR scrubs and ends up going to that incredibly cringeworthy dinner with them where Max gets drunk. It's like Max's animosity to him is because, for want of a better phrase, Luke Wilson's playing in Max's mind a Chad. You know, he's one of those handsome men who has done nothing to him, but like in Max's mind it's like, hey, I'm the romantic tortured victim here, I love this woman and she's here with this man doesn't deserve her, why do all the handsome assholes get to be with women and I don't, like you know, like, and I'm alone. And it's a mindset that is really, really pernicious, and it's obviously fed into a very toxic sphere now that the internet has become rife. You know, now that we are all connected, and so bad ideas can go and find other bad ideas. So Max Fischer, when I was thinking about it, I was like, it's interesting we mentioned our friends at Is Paul Dano Okay? Because their other podcast, Sudden Double Deep with Jeanette, recently they did an episode where they talked about Falling Down, which is another one of my favorite movies from when I was a teenager, which is obviously Michael Douglas has one really bad day, snaps and goes on this killing spree, and he's whining and complaining all the way through, and he's on an inexorable mission to go and, you know, even if he doesn't fully realize it, to go murder his ex-wife, you know, and daughter, and Robert Duvall has to stop him. And that movie became like hailed as like, almost like, hey, it's a white guy finally saying it like it is, yeah. You know what I mean? Like a lot of people love that movie for the wrong reasons. And Jeanette was, you know, very rightfully pointing out, you know, the ways in which that character is not a hero and he is a villain, you know, because he's being xenophobic, he's being racist, and he's being, you know, sexist, because he's basically going to go, you know, he was abusive to his wife and he was abusive to his mother, and he's going to go kill them. And that was a movie that when I was young, I used to love Michael Douglas's character, because Michael Douglas's character had a lot of rage in him. And me as a teenager, just feeling angry at the world, I had a bit of rage in me, too. But what was interesting about it was that, you know, I still think Falling Down is a great movie, because in that movie, Michael Douglas acknowledges at the end that he's the bad guy. There's this moment where he says, I'm the bad guy? How'd that happen? You know, like, it's a movie that 100% knows that this guy is the antagonist, not the protagonist. And he's the villain of his own story. He just doesn't know it. And, you know, you can actually definitely, you know, validly argue that there are pernicious elements to that film. Mm-hmm. You know, some people take the exact wrong message out of it. But I couldn't help but think about it when I was thinking about Rushmore, because Rushmore is like, Max Fischer is like the totally harmless version of the character from Falling Down. He's like, everyone goes through this period, if you're a boy, you know, who's lonely or sensitive, who's not popular, you're going to go through moments where you think, why do other people, you know, get to be with someone and not me? Or what is wrong with me? And why won't this woman that I have decided I'm in love with, you know, and I've decided that she must love me, like, why doesn't she do that? And so Max goes through all of these stages of what a lot of people go through. And it's interesting to me, because when I watched it, I was like, God, Max, don't let me down,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the rewatch. And I realized that this movie, it's perfect, because unlike a lot of other messaging sort of movies, which you know, tell men or boys how to be, this movie 100% understands that Max is ridiculous.
Yes.
And Jason Schwartzman knows that his character is ridiculous. He has empathy for him, but it's never, ever, ever unclear that Max is being an absolute idiot. And that's why it's so important that Miss Cross shuts him down in the way that she does and remains in integrity, and literally, like, you know, calls him on all of it, because it's a story about someone going right to the edge of what everyone goes to, but not, you know, having to become toxic or horrible. You know, like he basically alienates everyone around him all the way through the film. He tries to deceive Miss Cross into thinking that he's been hit by a car.
Yeah.
To try to find a way to romantically entangle with her.
Yeah, and then
he does a lot of insidious things. And a lot of his animosity is because he's in love at her and she's not living up to the version of her that he's created in his head.
I think that scene plays
really problematic.
That scene plays it really clever as well by letting the audience know that, like, Max is making it up as well. It's like, because he sneaks in, like, when he comes through the window, he sneaks in that, like, tape of, like...
He just immediately puts a tape in the tape player for some romantic music. Yeah. It's like everything he does is a play. Everything he does is something he's written. And that is not a million miles away from what, you know, kids do. And that's certainly something that I did when I was a kid. When I had my first crush, I fell absolutely hard and I was hyperbolic about it. Because when you first fall in love, it's like no one has ever been in love before.
Yeah.
Right? You feel like you invented love. You know what I mean? You become this obsessive egotist about how much you love somebody. And that person oftentimes is completely oblivious to the fact that you feel this way.
Yeah.
You know, especially if you're a shy, insular little boy. And an awful lot of my experience chimes with what happened with Max, right down to like some things that I deeply cringe at when I think back to my own life. Like, I feel a lot of regret about the ways in which I was infatuated with people who had done nothing to me. They'd done nothing wrong. They were perfectly sweet to me. And yet I, you know, basically made them my tormentor completely against their consent, you know? And I never acted in a way that was horrible. Like most of it was entirely inside my own head, but I acted out scenarios in my mind of, oh, you know, maybe she would appreciate me if I saved her life, or if I endured torture for her, then she would see. And it's like, it's as ridiculous as Max pretending to be hit by a car. Cause it's like, in what scenario are you going to get to be a hero? Like, unless you engineered it yourself, you'd be insane. Like, it's insane. But that's because when you're a teenager and you think you're in love, you are a bit insane.
What?
And so this movie really, really takes that and unpacks it and demystifies it and says, look, this is all silly.
Well,
this is all insane.
I think the film perfectly, like, lays it out by giving us that daydream at the beginning, because...
Yeah,
a lot of the kind of scenarios you've just listed there of that thing of like becoming the hero and like having all these like grand plans for like how you're going to win over your love are the types of things you would have like daydreamed, whether it's like on the bus or at school, like when you have that first crush. Like, there's many a times I'm sure
ways in which people will see your value.
Yeah, exactly. And people relate to this, or that thing of like you might see someone you fancy on the train, and then your whole journey. You kind of, especially like when you're like, yeah, like for me, and I was quite a sensitive teenager as well. Like, I remember I used to get the train to college and you'd see someone like, it was perfectly innocent. You'd kind of see them and be like, oh, they're very pretty. And then you would kind of just have this like weird daydream of like how things would plan out. And then like this almost like life together. And it's like this film almost like plays out those like daydreams, but then shows you like how that quickly turns into a nightmare. Because as you said earlier,
it proves that it's all built on a fallacy.
Yeah.
That like the fallacy being that they should acquiesce to your external feeling about what they should do and be. That like that you have some ownership over them because you feel love for them. You know, love is not ownership.
What?
You know, love is partnership. And when you're young, you don't know how to be in love with someone. You can only be in love at them.
Yes.
You know, in most cases, obviously, some people are lucky and they meet their high school sweetheart and get married. But like, that's not a lot of people's experiences. Like, there's a lot. I would always describe that whenever I was in the common room of school in high school, imagine that you could take like a red string, like a gunshot, like in a crime scene, and you could connect one person's eyes to the person they were interested in. None of those strings would ever intersect.
Yes.
There'd be like two couples who were like the sweethearts of the whole school, who were like the benefer of the school. And then you would have everyone else was just a tangle of red string, all looking at someone else. And it's all, it's just a recipe for tragedy. But when you're a boy and society has basically shoved all of these ideas of like, to be sexual is to have attained something. To have had sex is to have accomplished something. You know, I mean, no wonder women have developed such a sort of like a fear of men's interest. You know, like, you know, I mean, because obviously so much of it is untoward, because by the sheer nature that it's built on that fallacy, that we're somehow entitled to what we want just because we have decided that we want it. And it's not real, you know, and Max, you're right, Max's paper house, you know, crumbles, you know, his paper dream house with Miss Cross, you know, it's completely ripped to shreds, and then he has to start from the foundation upwards again and be who he really is.
To reiterate something you said earlier, that like your kind of daydreams only go so far, and as Max, like when he gets like rebuked by Miss Cross, it's like his daydream's not written any further past that point. And it's like, that is the thing, like you learn that lesson quite hard. That I think that dinner scene is the real first moment, like where you're like, oh God.
I like your nurse's uniform, guy.
These are OR scrubs.
Oh, are they? Well, they're totally inappropriate for the occasion.
Well, I didn't know we were going to dinner.
That's because you weren't invited.
Take it easy, Max.
You want to grab him by his like lapels of his jacket and shake him. And it's like that thing. And I think that's where, like, watching this film older, where I've like gone beyond the point of like relating to Max, where I am now one of I am Owen Wilson. I obviously meant to say Luke Wilson. Or I am Mr. Bloom at that table, kind of going like, yeah. I'm probably more Mr. Bloom because I probably would do something dumb, like give a fuck, like take a shot. Like
I would get someone a whiskey and soda without realizing the consequences.
yeah, or just that thing of like, I don't know, but I think that plays into like my kind of like that like father issue. So it's like, oh yeah, I want to take a kid under my wing. And I guess it's that thing of like, yeah, like that's what Bloom is trying to do. But like as the film progresses, we realize that it's not that at all, that they are very much from like two sides of the same coin. And Miss Cross says it perfectly, where it's like, you two deserve each other. And it's like,
you're both little children.
They are both children wanting to be men. And it's like, the fact is that Herman Bloom is a man, but it's like that thing of almost like, I don't know, you can only imagine that his life is like, yeah, he might have married his childhood sweetheart, and then before he knows it, he's made his millions, and then he's like, do you know what I mean, 30 years have gone down the line.
It's one of the lovely things about the fact that the final needle drop of the movie is I wish that I knew what I knew now when I was younger, you know? That, I mean, the whole movie is just that that summation, that basically, you know, you can't learn these lessons any other way but the painful way, you know what I mean? You can't just be wise immediately, otherwise Max would just be wise because he wants to be wise. You know, you can't be a good artist just because you decide I'm going to make a hit play, you know? You can't just end up with the woman you're supposed to end up with because you've decided, you know, that's what you're going to do without actually earning it. And you're right, like Max realizes he basically just realizes the hard way that he can't write his life. And there's a lovely intertextuality to that with the fact that Wes Anderson, you said how interesting it is that Wes Anderson would make a story about an unlikable character. Think about the power that Wes Anderson and Owen Wilson had to write a story any way they would want it. They could have written Max's fantasy out in a very idealized way. And so it shows their quality that they decided to use the entire film to harpoon that notion and actually take, you know, some responsibility for themselves by saying, hey, look, when we're young, we're fucking idiots, you know?
And
here's how.
What's like beautiful in this film is the way that like, and it is this running theme throughout Wes Anderson films where it's people searching for family. And in this case, it's like, it's not warranted because we realize that Max has a beautiful father at home who will like
do
anything for him. Like, and we see that like
so supportive
really early on, where he kind of gets 37 in a test and he changes it to an 87, and he's just kind of like, and one of the moments that like really like breaks my heart is, so obviously we have that kind of whole thing play out where Max and Bloom are kind of going toe to toe and like seeking vengeance on each other, and Max cuts his brakes and then and then gets arrested, and then he kind of like takes up this life of becoming a barber, and his dad says to him something to the effect of like, you know what, I've always enjoyed barbering, it's something I'm good at, but I always thought you'd do something more, you always wanted to be like a senator or something,
a diplomat.
And he just says, pipe dreams, dad, I'm a barber's son. And that is like, that is absolutely heartbreaking, because it's like it's like that thing of like, Max has got this image that if you're not from good stock, you shouldn't become good stock. And it's like, then there's that thing that obviously you've got the counterpoint to that, where you've got Bloom, who obviously, as you said earlier, is a self-made man. And it's like, it's all this kind of tapestry of Max learning these lessons of how, like, and it's like, it's frustrating watching this, like, somewhat, being that much older, because, like, when you get the introduction of Margaret Yang, you're like, you have got, like, you have got the perfect girl for you.
The perfect woman.
Yeah.
The perfect girl for Max. The perfect high school romance for Max.
It's right.
Clearly interested in him. Seems as, you know, on his level of intellect. You know, she seems precocious too. And like, yeah, you're right. Like, what are you doing? What's the matter with you, mate?
Yeah.
But it's so funny, because like, I love what you said about the dad. The dad is so beautifully sketched. It's a kind of character that doesn't show up a lot in other Wes Anderson movies. Like, you know, it's almost like Wes Anderson movies become populated entirely by Max Fisher's, you know.
Or bad dads. It's like...
Yeah, bad dads. Like, and so like, the dad is this really interesting character. And you can tell that there's a huge amount of it is Max's relationship to his mother, who's gone, who saw something brilliant in him and got him into Rushmore. What's really interesting about the movie is that the movie's called Rushmore, and yet he's only in Rushmore for the first third of the movie. Mm-hmm. Like, Rushmore, he gets expelled, or like towards basically the beginning of the second act.
Well, yeah,
and so the Rushmore itself hangs over the rest of the movie. It's his albatross around his neck, because you know how, like, you know, him and Bloom bond over this idea that you should do what you love for the rest of your life. And when Bloom is trying to explain his feelings for Miss Cross, he says, she's my Rushmore. You know, the Rushmore is this ideal of like this thing that you want to commit yourself to. And Max is obsessed with it, so much so that he still wears the uniform when he's in public school and when he's in regular life. And so this reminds me of something that happened when I went back to Oxford a couple of years ago. Because I, you know, I mentioned that, like, you know, when I was in school, I tried to be, you know, academic. I fancied myself to be, a good writer. I wanted to be a director. I made a short film when I was in school, you know, with a bunch of my friends. Like, I did a bunch of scrappy things to try to prove myself. But actually, like, I wasn't very good at science, maths. Me and my brother went to America when we were kids. And so we missed our times tables because the education systems are structured differently. So we came back and we're just stupid in math. We just had no idea how to do it. And we had to go to a tutor to just like scrounge our, I think it was a C eventually in our GCSEs. Like, and science wasn't that great. And basically the only thing I could do was writing, was English, was media studies, art, and basically all of the subjects that didn't require an empirically correct answer. Mm-hmm. You know, and I was good at history because history was just stories. And so I went through high school like basically wearing the fact that I was a writer on my sleeve. And trying to do everything I could to be that. And then I went to film school instead of going to Oxford, when maybe I could have gotten an English literature course in Oxford because I did well in those subjects. But I decided to go to film school, a practical film school, where we got to handle 60mm film, because like my dream was, I'm going to become a filmmaker. I'm going to go to the National Film and Television School for my master's, and that's going to be my thing. I'm going to become Max Fischer, essentially. You know what I mean? I'm going to be Max Fischer, and I'm going to have the David Trumble players. You know what I mean? And I don't think I ever yelled at someone, don't fuck with my play, but I probably was close at some point, I'm sure. got a fucking punch in the nose, I'm sure. But the story of my life didn't go that way because that's just not how life is. You can't structure it that way. I left film school, and because I majored in directing and gotten a grad film, I didn't have any actual skills when I left uni. Like, I wasn't an editor. I didn't know how to edit. I didn't know how, I wasn't in the camera crew. I had no actual transferable skills to get a job in the industry. So I actually, you know, drifted and treaded water for most of my 20s, realizing that I put all of my eggs into this one basket of, I'm going to become a filmmaker. I'm going to become a great filmmaker. And actually had not given myself any way of becoming one. And so I lent on my other abilities, and I did illustration. I was a political cartoonist. And for a long time, I felt like film was like, had become a pipe dream, you know, like, not like I'm a barber's son, but like, you know what, maybe this isn't the right path for me. And it wasn't until I decided to go towards something else that meant something to me that I actually found the people, my tribe, in animation. And animation is something that incorporated a skill that I actually did have, which was writing and art and drawing and draftsmanship, but also incorporated everything I knew about filmmaking, like, you know, shot language, editing, and all these things that I didn't have a discipline in, but understood because I you know, grown up on film. And so weirdly, I ended up getting to the life of actually being a filmmaker, but not by trying to be a filmmaker, you know? To cut this long story short, like, my journey of expectation was built upon institutions. I was like, I'm going to get into the National Film and Television School because that's what filmmakers do. They go to the National Film and Television School. And I didn't get in. I applied, like, I think 3 times and didn't get in. And so 3 years of heartbreak of just like, I had this expectation. I had this path I'd written for myself and it didn't happen. Now I'm working at Netflix Animation, and I've worked with Henry Selick, which is actually a Coppola connection because he worked on like Steve Zissou, you know, like, and actually I have even more Wes Anderson connections because Selick's movie Wendell and Wild, I just finished, you know, the production designer is the same production designer from Isle of Dogs.
Oh, amazing. So
just to give you an indication of how beautiful this movie is going to look when it comes out. And a lot of the animators actually worked on The Fantastic Mr. Fox, who I met when I went to Portland, Oregon. And they told me some really great stories. Maybe I'll tell you a little bit about that at the end. Cut that long story short, me and my girlfriend revisited England after a long period away. And I was showing her Oxford. We were walking around, and it's a beautiful town, beautiful university town, lots of great buildings. And I was just showing her all of the college campuses, you know, like walking past the Radcliffe Camera, the Bodleian Library, the Ashmolean, and just like saying, oh, and here are the grounds. This is the Oxford University. We went past these massive gates. You could see into this like beautiful green sort of courtyard, very much like Rushmore. And Dana looked at them, and she was like looking and going, yeah, they're good. And I was like, what do you think of them? And then she said, well, can I be perfectly honest? I think all I see are really, really tall, high stone walls that no one can see over. And the big message that I see is only good people can go in here.
Mm-hmm.
And back when Oxford was, you know, first created, that meant white men,
mm-hmm.
you know, that people of color now can go into the university, women can go into the university. But for the longest time, those walls signified that only great men are allowed to learn in these hallowed hall. That there's this massive privilege that has now been given a literal wall, a stone wall, so strong, you can't see in it. You can't climb up and see it. There's no way you can get in unless you're brilliant. And that is a small, small aperture, you know,
mm-hmm.
That only a few lucky, privileged people can get into. And she said, you know, walking around this town actually explains an awful lot about you to me, that you grew up thinking you were going to do and be these things because you were surrounded by this brilliance and these symbols, these archaic symbols of achievement. You know, that they're like, you know, Oxford is the home of J.R.R. Tolkien, the home of C.S. Lewis. It's a great author town. It's a town that is my Rushmore. And I thought about the concept of walls when I was watching Rushmore again. Like, Max keeps going back to Rushmore. He keeps going back to the campus, even though he's been kicked out. Mm-hmm. He burns leaves there, like in defiance, but he still chooses Rushmore as the place to go. Yeah. because that's the only place that makes any sense to him. It was his plan. I think the movie is so great about it because it not only does it take apart the sort of incel idea of like, I'm entitled to the person I'm infatuated with, or like, you know, like that everyone has to conform to what I think, but also the idea that institutions don't matter.
Yeah.
That like brilliant people can come from anywhere. And in fact, a lot of the best people are dropouts from institutions, you know, a lot of, and then I was thinking about it, like, through the prism of my own life, like not only have I been able to have meaningful relationships after I got rid of all that bullshit that I had in my mind about what my life was supposed to be, but also I actually ended up in the industry that I wanted to a completely different path. And so much of Rushmore conforms to like my formative years, but it means so much more to me now as an adult looking back. It's only become more therapeutic to me as I get older. It reaffirms everything that I've learned. And I, especially as I become more and more mortified over my past behaviors and beliefs, you know, like I look back at it and I cringe when I look at Max Fischer. It's like one of my favorite films to watch, and yet it feels like going to the dentist.
Yeah.
It's like, it's necessary root canal for the soul to watch Max Fischer be such an idiot and to know that it's not a million miles away from what I was, and to be like, okay, but I'm on the right path now.
Well, I think that's what the film very much says as well. It's that thing of like, once Max strips away that kind of, once he gets rid of it, that albatross around his neck, he gets rid of Rushmore as that ideal, is when he can truly become who he is. And like, kind of, he can accept the fact that like, he's had this glaring like love interest in front of his eyes the whole time, and he's kind of like,
yeah,
he takes those things that he learnt from Rushmore, and like he wants to kind of like, he sets up the kind of the society for like the kite flyers and stuff like that.
The kite flying society, yeah. Well, that scene with the kite is my favorite scene. It's so beautifully shot. Yeah. Margaret is so great. One little tangent about Margaret. I love that she is an Asian character in that film. And Wes Anderson's not known for a lot of diversity in his movies. There's a lot of white characters who are the heroes. I really like that Margaret Yang does not conform to two very pernicious Asian stereotypes. So one is that she fakes her results. So she doesn't tick the box of Asians are all incredibly smart, like overachievers. She actually like is also proving that she's someone who has high expectations of her that she doesn't necessarily always meet. And she's honest about it. But the other thing I like about it, this is said a lot in podcasts that we both listen to, which is like, I hate the Asian stereotype of being mysterious and quiet and mute. Mm-hmm. So she's a character who talks and has a lot to say, has a great personality. She's like, she's Max Fisher's perfect partner.
Well, yeah.
And so I actually really love her. She's a small role, but she actually navigates a couple of cliches and does away with them, which I like.
Well, yeah, and you're showing like visually that she throws herself into things, because obviously she plays like the girlfriend in Max's play he's putting on at the like community, at the school, which I
at the school.
I love those references, because I think like that one specifically is like a kind of reference, like a blood in blood out type film, where you've kind of got like the cholos riding around in their cars and stuff like that. And then like, yeah, the play he puts on at the end, which like,
in which he proposes to her character at the end,
which is perfect,
like the romantic apocalypse now.
Yeah, and it feels like that for me, it feels like Wes Anderson and Owen Wilson are saying like, we know who your uncle is, Jason.
Just so you know, we're gonna lean into these homages. Yeah.
Well, there's another perfect homage as well near the beginning of the film, when Max is in Guggenheim's office when he's first told like he's gonna be expelled from the school essentially, yeah. And he says like, "Oh, can't I just like float on by, or like can't I just skate on by?" Which is a direct reference to a line that Sal says to Tom Hagen in The Godfather, when they're kind of when they're all like crowding around him, and he's like,
"Tom, can you get me off the hook? For old time's sake."
"Can't do it, Sally."
And that's like nearly word for word what Max says in that, like, and it's great because it all ties back into that thing of like, I imagine at the age of 17, like,
yeah,
a deep cut.
It's like, yeah, my first short film that I ever made was Reservoir Dogs in a school toilet.
But, like, it's that thing at the,
you know, like, yeah, yeah. We have all these immediate direct influences, which is just whatever we watched a year before,
but,
you know?
But I think it's that thing that, like, at the age of 17, that Max, Jason Schwartzman wouldn't have known that that's a reference to The Godfather.
Yeah.
And it's, yeah, like, I just love the fact that those guys were like, we're going to put that in there. And, like, yeah, kind of, like, looking to, like, the end of this film and, like, some of the scenes. So, like, that, there's a couple of lines that I absolutely love in this film. One of them is when Max kind of comes back to the school and is told that, like, Buchan is after him.
Yeah.
And he says, tell that stupid Mick I've made a list of things to do. Tell that stupid Mick.
He's made my list of things to do today.
Yeah. And it's like,
I'm going to pop a cap in his ass.
That, like, that's brilliant. And, like, again, the character of Dirk Calloway is fantastic. And there's that beautiful scene between those two in the barber shop where he presents Max with the penknife, with the kind of, like, his year's tenure at Rushmore Academy. And as we get to the end, and a bit of trivia as well, all the photos of Edward Appleby, so Mrs. Cross's, like, dead husband, all of the photos in his bedroom are Owen Wilson as a kid.
That's so cool.
So, like, even though he's not in the film, he's like,
he's in
the film. Yeah,
he's,
yeah,
Edward Appleby.
Yeah,
which is funny because his character dies at sea in The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou, which is such an interesting nod there. Like, they didn't even know. It's just like, it just works out nicely.
Well,
it's funny because, like, we haven't even mentioned the funny thing is, this movie's so dense, we haven't even mentioned, like, how brilliant Brian Cox is.
Brian Cox
as Guggenheim.
Brian Cox,
he's so fucking funny. The way that he charts him from, like, this really sort of, like, quite sweet sort of, like, gravitas kind of, like, dean of this college, of this high school, and then as it goes along, his patience with Max just erodes, and it goes to that point where he's trying to get Miss Cross fired, and he's like, I never took you for an informant, Max, and Max is like, what's that supposed to mean? And then Brian Cox just goes, "This is supposed to mean," like, just Brian Cox just ends up having no fucks whatsoever, right through to the fact that after Dr. Guggenheim has a stroke, Max's voice is the only thing that will stir him out of his, like, coma. It's like, it's pressure. What do you want? It's so funny.
The thing is, like, the supporting cast throughout this film are fantastic. Whether it's
it's exceptional.
Scottish actor who plays Buchan as well, like that.
Yeah, he's fantastic.
Like,
I loved hearing him on the Dead Eyes podcast recently, because he was in Band of Brothers in the scene where the host of Dead Eyes, you know, lost a role, and, like, he was interviewed in that podcast, and I was like, oh, it's really nice to hear that guy, to hear that he's actually a really sweet dude. But, like, you know, like, Buchan is a great character.
Yeah,
he's more than a bully, because just like the movie deconstructs everyone in the story, not only is the victim and the hero not the hero or the victim, you know, Max Fischer is actually the architect of his own doom, but Buchan is also not really the villain either. He's just a guy who's got his own problems, because when I think back to my own bullies in Oxford, like, you know, a lot of them were making up for other feelings that they had and problems of their own. And they were creating a character as much as I was. You know, their character was, I don't give a fuck.
Yeah, and I'm sure if you looked into Buchan's life, and he's like, what, he's a Scottish kid who's at an academy in Texas, I think, like, is where that academy would have been, despite its kind of really autumnal-looking, like, setting. Like, but, like, yeah, so he's there, so his life is probably not great. He's probably got, like, probably living in some really strict circumstances where he's, like, living with another family and stuff like that. Do you know what I mean? Like, he's probably there on some kind of exchange program. And then, like, yeah, it's just, I don't know. Yeah, we've mentioned earlier the actor, Little Jeans and stuff like that. And I love the way that it all plays back in at the end. So when we come to, like, Max's final play, we get that panning shot of just kind of, like, everyone we've been introduced to.
Everyone that's been in his orbit this whole time. I mean, the third act's really beautiful. Right down, like, I mean, from that, you know, kite-flying scene onwards, like, the kite-flying scene is actually really important to the plot, because if you chart that this whole film is about someone who's deceiving himself and others, that the kite-flying scene is so transformative for him, because he sees Margaret. Margaret admits to having faked results, and then just says immediately after that, like, you know, you're a jerk to me. You know, you're a real jerk to me. And he says, I'm sorry. And it's the same scene in which he says to his friend Calloway, like, I'm sorry that I lied about your mother giving me a hand job in the back of her car. It's like, basically, this whole sequence is the first time Max has an actual honest conversation with anyone. Mm. He's not pretending that his father's a surgeon. He's not pretending that he is some brilliant genius. He just has a conversation with Margaret, and that's why she's the right girl for him. They have a moment where she's just Margaret and he's just Max. So that's what jumpstarts him back to creating the kite flying society, because it's like he finds a way to take everything that he is, that he loves, and then put it into his own identity, that is his real identity. He doesn't have to make one. And so that's why immediately afterwards, when he sees Bill Murray, two things. You know how his blazer is like his superhero costume from Rushmore? Yeah. The first time you see him not in that blazer is after that scene. And he shows up in this all green tweed suit jacket and trousers.
Yeah, it's like velvet, right?
It's like he's made his own, but it's like he's made his own superhero outfit. He looks like the fucking Riddler. You know what I mean? He looks like, he's like, exactly. I mean, right down to the fact that like when he puts the bees in Bill Murray's apartment, there's that amazing slow motion shot of him leaving and putting gum on the, on the wall as he's like leaving, and he looks like a supervillain. Like he looks like a member of, you know, Gotham's criminal establishment. Yeah. But when he shows up with Bill Murray, he's chosen an outfit that is Max Fischer, and he's no longer pretending to be Max Fischer of Rushmore. And then when he takes Bill Murray in, that's the other thing that makes me almost want to cry, is when he introduces his father, the barber, to Bill Murray after spending so long saying that he's a brain surgeon. And so everything from that point onwards, the final third act is just Max being honest. Mm-hmm. And honesty is the key that unlocks everything else in his life. To the fact that, like, you know, at the very end, yeah, we should talk about just like that ending. Because after the play, it's like, I don't know. For all of the sort of like moments that make me feel really uncomfortable about my own life when I watch the movie, it has such a beautiful final note to me.
Yeah, that is the thing. It's a film that sideswipes you in the fact that throughout it you're kind of deconstructing this like horrible little kid, basically, and then like you build him up into this way where at the end you're like, there is still that trace of the old Max Fischer, like even down to the fact like he's still kind of got that like way about him where he's like clicking his fingers like, so
yeah,
go get me some more ketchup. But it seems a lot more manageable at this point.
Well, it's like he's using his powers for good, not evil.
Yeah.
He's using them to help people and build people up. He wants to get Bloom and Miss Cross back together. And the film does a very good job, actually, of juggling a happy ending with reality. In that I like that Wes Anderson stops just short of letting you know whether Miss Cross and Bloom go get back together. It's like an ending that feels kind of in the right way ambiguous, that there's a kind of reconciliation there, but it's never fully explicitly stated, you know? And then at the very end, I love that Margaret like identifies herself as Max's girlfriend. Mm. And Max's father has a dance with his teacher from the public school, and you see everyone is enjoying this after-show party together. And then Miss Cross asks Max to dance. And this is interesting for me because I want to ask what your opinion is, because like we've mentioned how brilliant Olivia Williams is in this film because she has to walk a line. Her performance when she takes his glasses off and they go and dance is actually really, in my opinion, like detailed.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's got a lot of texture in it. And like, what do you think the last look between them signifies?
I think it's an element of like they're at like almost peace at being friends. And like, and it is that thing. I know it's like a weird concept to be like, arguably a woman in her late 20s, early 30s, is friends with a 15-year-old boy. But then again, this is like, I don't know, it's played in a way that like in this world, it kind of all makes sense. Like Max is, and the way that Max is as well. Like we've all met those kids who are very precocious and kind of like, seem like a 40-year-old man when you meet them at like 15. Do you know what I mean? It's like, yeah, why wouldn't they, like, why wouldn't a 45-year-old man be their like best friend and stuff like that? Yeah. And I do think that thing of like, it's because it can be read, and I know there are people who have issues with this film, like because of the whole like that whole like age gap thing and stuff like that. But it's never like it's never fully explored. Like let's be honest, this isn't Lolita. Like
no, she 100% makes it clear that attraction doesn't enter into it when she first rejects him. She's like, "You're 15 years old. That's not happening." And so like she's 100%, you know, across the board responsible in the way that she treats him. But the thing I like about that last moment is like, yeah, you're right. It's like, it is a moment of them actually becoming friends because, like I said, like because Max has finally stopped pretending to be something that he isn't. I feel like when he looks at her and obviously that incredible, you know, Ooh La La song, you know, comes on, which is just so beautiful. You see, he looks at her and she takes his glasses off. And I almost feel like it's almost like she actually meets Max for the first time.
Yeah.
When he's the first time he's not pretending to be something else. And there's something incredibly powerful about when someone has actually fully actualized themselves.
Well,
when they are, you know, finally able to let go of pretend.
I think it might be a case of the fact as well that like he may like, I don't know, somehow resemble her dead husband. And like it's that thing of like she takes off those glasses and like it looks more like him, but it's like that thing of like she appreciates the kind of like that aspect of him, but at the same time like it's like I've very much got a friend here, and I just love that kind of whole like ending, and like even like, and we get glimpses to kind of stuff that Wes Anderson would do a lot more in his later career, with like there is a moment of Mr. Little Jeans in the background doing like, you know, the trick with a rope where like you pretend to do a knot and then it like it comes open and it's like, then obviously later on down the line in Wes Anderson's career, it's like you have that moment when they're walking in Moonrise Kingdom, and you've got all like all the crazy things going on in the background, and everything's kind of like very stylized and to the point. And it's like,
yeah, all the lateral tracking shots. Warners. Yeah.
So, but you,
I mean, like, yeah, and that ensemble, like, you know, as we've said, how brilliant the ensemble is. That final shot where he goes full Anderson and goes into like really super slow motion as it goes to them dancing on the dance floor. I love the fact that even Brian Cox in his wheelchair is like wheeled into the corner of the frame. And because it's so slow, it's almost like he's created like a modern Renaissance painting.
Yeah.
Before the curtain falls on it, you know, that wonderful framing device, the curtain. But you see that ensemble and all the weird, wonderful characters he's created, but it's sort of like crystallized, almost like frozen, you know, for the audience in that final frame.
So I was amazed to find out that all of those like curtain shots were done practically. And like they actually had like, so they projected onto the curtains.
Oh, the words?
The words. And then like,
that's so cool.
But it was done like with a certain projector, in that like obviously once they opened, it couldn't be seen anymore.
Yeah.
And then like,
it's so brilliant. I mean, like there's so many technical aspects to the movie that we're not even touching on, but it's because it's just so, I mean, like even the editing choices, like I love the framing structure of the seasons and going through an entire year of this boy's life, but there's that amazing cut to the song I Am Waiting by The Stones, when Bill Murray takes a twig off of the tree that Max had rigged to crush him in the graveyard, and it does a perfect cut of the tree landing to the cut to the curtain and the next season.
Well, like we could talk for hours about the needle drop. I love the moment when it's Oh Yoko by John Lennon is playing, and they have that kind of like montage of Max and Bloom becoming friends again, and they're kind of like,
I love that.
They've got that like
them running around like,
yeah, like
exercising,
like flash like flash dance in the steel mill and stuff like that, and
lifting their little pipes up like weights. It's so charming.
Yeah, and like I think it's a very like it's such a like a charming film, and like it is that thing that it's got such a great payoff at the end of it, because it is that thing that it makes you squirm, it makes you like go, oh, this is cringe, it makes you cringe throughout it, but then like that payoff is like you go, oh fuck, like you realize I've been there, like, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, and you just have to, you do punch the air for Max at the end. You're just so happy for him to no longer be imprisoned in his own, in like expectations.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like, I've never, like when I was a teenager, this came out before my first big crush, but I revisited that movie a lot in my teens because that character I felt such a kinship with, because we were both as deluded as each other. And that movie gave me a language to be able to laugh at myself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that made how histrionic I became over people who didn't return my affections, you know, like it made me, it allowed me a visual language to be able to step outside of myself and be like, you're being ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like, and don't worry, this too shall pass, which is the other message of the movie, which is that it charts the entire stages of infatuation, which is that eventually infatuation ends and reality sets back in.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
So you just feel so much happiness to see him comfortably settle back into his life. And I think, just to finish my thoughts on it, just because, like, as I said, this is like, you know, I actually have a really emotional connection to this movie, and it's more than a lot of other Wes Anderson movies, probably just because I really find them technically and visually stunning and enjoyable, but I don't relate to all the characters as much as I relate to Max.
Mm.
But the thing with Max is that final moment when they go to dance together as friends, I definitely had a different feeling to that ending now than I did when I watched it. Because when I first watched it, I watched it through the prism of I'm living Max's pain.
Mm-hmm.
And this time I was struck by a very different emotion, which was regret. This movie actually, the ending's beautiful, but it's also kind of sad to me.
Mm-hmm.
Because like I said, I think back with a lot of mortification at how much of an emo like fool I was when I was a teenager. And there were plenty of times when I would like fall for somebody and I wasn't really seeing them. I was just seeing my own needs to feel validated or to feel loved or to, like, you know, to have what other people had, you know, like extensions of my loneliness, which is just no way to relate to people. And everyone was perfectly sweet to me, but there were people who, you know, they would see that, like when I was young, they'd see that I was interested in them, and they would just walk the other way because they were smart, you know what I mean, like, you know, because they weren't idiots, you know. Mm-hmm. And the feeling I felt when I was thinking back on this movie, and the reason why I think it's really powerful to me, is that I think the biggest regret of my teenage years, like there's plenty that's just teenage shit. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But if I had a single regret of my teens, it's something that I could not have possibly understood until now, which is how much I missed out on having friends who were women.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like for a long time I thought, oh, I missed out on having a relationship because I didn't do relationships. But now I've been in relationships, and you know, now that whole thing's been demystified to me. But the biggest gift of my adult life is having friends who are girls.
Yes.
It's like removing that automatic like process that happens in your brain when you meet a girl, and it's like, oh, that person is immediately in your mind as a potential person you could have a relationship with, or a potential someone that you could court in some way. And it's like, after you settle down into yourself and you become, you know, an actualized human being, you live in reality. And even, you know, if you were single, like that, there's this entire other half of the world that's a completely different experience to you. And we as men have not been trained by society in any way to properly understand or interact with it. We've been conditioned to see it as, or to see them as conquests, or as something to bolster your ego in some way, that I am loved because I'm with this person, or I am vital because I bedded this person. And now when I think about like my friends who do podcasts, my friends from college, the people I work with, some incredible story artists, filmmakers, you know, just the wealth of just incredible human beings.
Mm-hmm.
that I have now had the privilege of knowing, it comes to me like how utterly cheap it is to just reduce them when you're a young person to that. And like, I don't look back on my school days and think, God, I really wish I had been cooler. Like, you know, that song, like the end song is like, I wish that I knew what I know now when I was younger. And I do, but not because I wish that I could go back and be cooler and get a girlfriend, but because I wish I could go back and undo some of those friendships I never got the chance to have with people who were just great people, like just mates, you know, like the number of things that I could have learned, you know, times I could have had and connections I could have made. And so now I feel like, you know, nowadays it's my pleasure to try my best to just undo that. But some of those things can never be undone, you know, and that's a regret that I have. And this movie, you know, hits the nail on the head for me on that. And so it's one of the reasons why I think it's just a fantastic movie, and definitely the Wes Anderson movie that speaks to me the most.
Thank you so much for sharing that, David. And I think something that really chimes to that perfectly, and this film weirdly subverts, is the fact that a lot of films, especially in the kind of like early 2000s to mid 2000s, created this thing of like, well, it's male writers writing women. And I think it kind of like, I don't know, it very much plays to how a lot of like men then looked at women, where it's like this kind of like the invention of the manic dream, like
pixie dream. The male gaze is not just visual, it is also what you write.
Yeah, and it's like, I think it was perfectly summed up on an episode of Films to Be Buried With, the Brett Goldstein podcast, where they kind of like look back at Garden State and say, like, looking back at that film now, you go, oh no, like you realize, like, you don't want that at that point. It's like you don't want to find a woman who's got all those, like, basically if you wanted to date someone who likes all the same stuff as you, like, especially when you're a teenager and you're watching those films, it's like, well, just date one of your friends then. Date your male friend who's into the same things. And for me, a film that like very much, I think, I don't know, very much is the way that you kind of look at Rushmore. For me, it's High Fidelity, that thing of like,
yes,
for years,
another classic movie.
For years, I kind of lived by that motto of like, it's not what you're like, it's what you like that matters. And it's that thing of like, I remember giving the book of that to an ex-girlfriend, and I kind of like, do you know what I mean, like I'd idolized Rob Gordon, and she like kind of she took it on holiday with her and she read it and then like kind of came back to me and was like, he's a bit of a dick.
He is. It's another great character who the writer, if not the people always reading it, knows is in the wrong, you know. There's someone taking aim at their own behaviors and owning them, you know.
Yeah, whereas like
it's a masterpiece
at the time when you're like a kind of thing, you're like, yeah, I'm really into like obscure music, I'm really into like vinyl and like being elitist about like bands or films and stuff like that. And then you realize like, I know that's quite like, it's not until you get hindsight and you realize it's quite like toxic behavior, and it's not about,
it's deeply toxic. Yeah. It's so toxic.
Yeah, it's like you're just a gatekeeping dickhead. Do you know what I mean? And it's like, as I get older, I realize like, oh no, I'm not Rob Gordon, I'm Dick. I'm Dick, you know, like the bald guy who works in the shop.
Yeah, you're Dick.
Where it's like, I just want to share things that I love with people. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, I might have my Barry tendencies now and then where I'm like, what? You don't know about this band? Fuck
yeah,
you.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
But yeah, like,
we live in an online world. You can't live in an online world and not become Barry at some point. You know what I mean? But deep down, we're all more of a Dick.
We've all had our Max Fischer moment, but hopefully we've come out the end of it. We've written our heaven and hell, and we've
found our Margaret Yang.
Perfect. Well, David, let's score this film. And the scoring system on this podcast is quite unique. And I always ask, what would be your perfect wine pairing for this film?
Okay, so I thought a little bit about this, and I'm not a very good connoisseur of wine, but then again, I part of me feels like Max isn't either. Mm-hmm. Then Max would just get the most expensive wine on the list because he would know Bloom was going to pick up the check for it. Or charge it to like their manufacturing company. But you know what? I'm going to forego the wine, and I'm going to say this movie is best enjoyed with an underage whiskey and soda.
Perfect.
That's you know, if he can write a hit play, then why can't he have a drink to unwind himself? Whiskey and soda it is.
Well, I'm going to say for this film, just because it's my last chance to mention it, that this should be enjoyed with a Budweiser, because just to mention. Herman Bloom's perfect, amazing Budweiser shorts, which like I have.
You sent me that pic that they exist somewhere.
Well, yeah, like his ones are actually Budweiser, but somebody's created these amazing like Bloom Budweiser shorts. So if you've seen the film, the shorts he's wearing, and so yeah, and it's like I've since looked, and you can actually get the Budweiser ones as well, which I think may be a purchase for me for this summer.
We know what to get you for your birthday.
Yeah, exactly. But that's a perfect answer, I think. And one of Francis Ford Coppola's notes on the film when he saw it was the wine that is behind Max at that dinner scene is actually Coppola like winery's rivals wine.
Oh.
And that is one of the notes that he made to them when he saw the film, was like,
how fucking dare you?
Yeah. Which I think it's perfect. They've got all these lovely nods to him, but then they do the ultimate snub.
Anderson alienating Coppola right off the bat. He's going to wake up and find Fantastic Mr. Fox head on a pillow, bloodily, like next to him.
So how much like are you paying for that bottle of wine, David?
Do you know what? I've got like a limit. I'm like, in the, I'd like to believe I'd spend more, but I think that after a certain amount, it's just them taking the piss, no matter how good the wine is. So I'd probably give it about, do you know what? It depends on the occasion, but I could go up to like 25.
Perfect.
£25, $25. I mean, like you know, like there's a little leeway there. Mm-hmm. If it went up to 30, if it was like a really special occasion, but like very, very few instances in which I would drink wine anyway.
But yeah, if this,
and it would probably be like something really, really easy, like Pinot Grigio. Or something. It would be like, wouldn't even be a red.
Perfect. Well, I think we know the answer to this one, but would you recommend people check out this film?
Absolutely. I mean, I'm not going to be didactic and say that it's like required viewing, but I wish every teenage boy could be sat down and made to watch this film, because it is a perfect how-to on overcoming a lot of the problems that young boys struggle with when they first become aware of their feelings and their desires. I think it's a perfect antidote to toxic sort of masculine fantasies, precisely because it points out that the emperors have no clothes, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
I'd recommend it to people of all ages.
I'm very much looking forward to like showing this one to my son when he's like of an age, and like that thing of like, I think
even a kid would love it because of Calloway, you know, like that there are characters that everyone would love in this.
Yeah, I think it should be prescribed to boys of 15. And then again, you should like have it marked in your calendar for when you like when you become a parent to then watch it. Do you know what I mean? When you become of age, and it's kind of like you're far enough from your teenage years to watch it again, and then like kind of, I don't know, see it through the Bloom perspective. Or
and also, if for no other reason that this will make it a given that you will then go and watch the rest of Wes Anderson's films, because it's the perfect signature film for him.
Well, yeah, I think it's that thing, as I said earlier, it is the final departure, like it's that kind of stepping stone before kind of like
before Tenenbaum,
Wes Anderson land. Do you know what I mean? Where it's this kind of like everything after then, kind of, even though Tenenbaum is set in New York, it's like that thing of like it's not new.
It's Wes Anderson's New York.
Yeah, it's whereas this, like seeing Max in the kind of like the school and stuff like that. And it's that thing of like, oh, I think this is like the last Wes Anderson film where we see working class people.
Well, like, to some degree, criticize the movie. It is possible to nitpick this film. I mean, this movie has things that you know could be better in terms of representation. He ends up in an inner city school. Obviously, he ends up with Margaret Yang, but like, you know, you'd think that would be an opportunity to inject more, you know, characters of color into the story. And you know, he works with people for his play, but you know, the cast, like all Wes Anderson casts, are primarily white and very much, you know, male oriented. You know. So yeah, I mean, like, it's not a movie that can't be criticized. It's just a movie that I absolutely adore for what it is.
Yeah, you know? And I think Wes Anderson very much falls into that kind of same criticism that a lot of people level at Sofia Coppola, where it's that thing that, like, they are writing about white privileged people. And it's a difficult one because it is that thing of, like, with Sofia Coppola, it's like, well, I think that is all she has ever known. Do you know what I mean?
Like, yes. So it's like, if anyone has the right to talk about it, it is probably her. But also, it means that, like, you know, does that mean that the, you know, that she's got more diverse stories in her? You know what I mean? Like, that's the interesting thing. Yeah. It's like, but sometimes someone's specific worldview is exactly what makes them perfect for a specific piece. You know,
exactly.
If all Sofia Coppola made was Lost in Translation, you know, that's still a big bucket of wind to me because it feels so pure in its focus, you know, and another great Murray performance, of course.
Well, let's talk about the Coppola family in a wider perspective, in that which Coppola member would you keep, but in doing so you had to get rid of every single filmography of every other Coppola family?
Well, see, this is where you get me into Sophie's Choice territory, because you're asking me to sacrifice one of my friends, and one of them is you. because if I don't choose Nicolas Cage, then the Cage In podcast doesn't happen. We don't meet, so and you don't have a podcast. So I just want you to know, I apologize to Max, that I'm basically destroying everything you've worked so hard to build. Talk about the butterfly effect. I flap my wings, Petros Petsilovas disappears from my entire life. So I'm going to have to say what I think is inevitable, because I think a lot of people are going to have to inevitably conclude this, that I have to keep Francis Ford Coppola, and that's not a mark against any of the other people. In fact, I wish I could keep Nicolas Cage. I wish I could keep, you know, Jason Schwartzman. I wish I could keep a lot of these people, because obviously I just spent like a whole 2 hours talking about how much I fucking love Rushmore. But the problem with it is that it's about the knock-on butterfly effect, which is that Francis Ford Coppola disappears, then he never goads George Lucas into making Star Wars. He never dares George Lucas to become a filmmaker. George Lucas doesn't make Star Wars. Because of that, George Lucas doesn't make Indiana Jones with Steven Spielberg. And so Steven Spielberg's career goes off in a different direction. Because Star Wars doesn't exist, Star Trek never gets revived because, you know, after vanishing in the 60s from the TV show, the motion picture was only, you know, bankrolled because they wanted to have their own Star Wars. So because of that, the Spocklight podcast disappeared, and suddenly Liam and Matt and Paul are out on their asses. And it's like, basically, he's the one thread that you pull him and the entire rug goes up. But the funny thing about it is that, like, I don't even know if it's possible to remove Francis Ford Coppola and lose everyone else. Because if you did lose everybody else, right, but only kept Francis Ford Coppola, then surely Francis Ford Coppola would still end up making all their careers anyway.
Yeah.
So it gets into existential territory. Yeah, you're sneaky. Francis Ford Coppola, like, you could say, like, oh, I'd want to keep Nicolas Cage. But if you kept Francis Ford Coppola, Nicolas Cage might still end up becoming Nicolas Cage. But is this a reality where they're literally removed from existence and it's just Francis Ford Coppola?
It's Francis Ford Coppola only, I'm afraid, yes. But, like,
okay, well, then we will be... in that case, I'm terribly sorry. I know the Cajun podcast, I know you put a lot of work into it, but...
That's perfectly fine. I
just love movies too much, man.
I totally hear your sentiment, because Francis Ford Coppola, like, it can be argued, created the blockbuster, like... a film never did the kind of sales a film did before The Godfather, like, and it's like that thing of, like, I think, like, national distribution kind of hit its like peak at for its time with The Godfather. And it's like, there's so many films, do you know what I mean? You wouldn't have had people like pushing for stuff after that. And it's like, I don't know, would without The Godfather, would we have even got The Exorcist? Do you know what I mean? Like, would people be making those chances on stuff that is very adult centric, that like, do you know what I mean? But could also play to a wide audience.
It is insane to think that like three of the most influential filmmakers of the 20th century all were in the same basic sphere of friends. Like, the notion of a Brat Pack today feels almost unheard of. Like, can you imagine another like room of three directors who are going to have that much of an impact or ripple effect on cinema? I can't, you know? I mean, like, obviously you need Akira Kurosawa to get to Star Wars too, but like, you know, I mean, in terms of the Coppola family, like, that is a nexus of talent right there.
Well, I've said it without, like, I've said it before on this podcast, without Francis Ford Coppola literally seeing George Lucas, because he had won a competition through his university to be on like a soundstage at Warner Brothers, where Francis Ford Coppola was shooting Finian's Rainbow. And he kind of saw this guy who was under the age of 40, who had a beard, do you know what I mean? Who was like in his similar age bracket, and went, hey, what are you doing? Hey, I'm going to be filming this film, The Rain People. Do you want to come film? I'll get them to pay for you to do the behind the scenes footage.
Yeah, and didn't he like dare him to do like a popular film, like something that wasn't sci-fi, and then that's how we got American Graffiti, you know? Like,
yeah, like
basically Francis Ford Coppola busting George Lucas's balls is like the reason we have George Lucas.
Well, yeah, and I think if it's not for that kind of like almost sibling rivalry aspect of like this thing of like, well, I'm doing this, well, I'm going to outdo you, like that kind of gang had of this. And it's like the thing of like, they wouldn't have had, you wouldn't have had Star Wars in the way of like, he's like, oh, well, I want to one up you guys. And it's like, without that kind of like, that butting back and forth, yeah, we wouldn't have got it. But we could, that this could be another 2 hour conversation. So let me.
Indeed. I mean, like, I thought we were going to have another 2 hours just on High Fidelity. We could have.
So, yeah, let me ask you the ultimate question. Are they the greatest film family of all time?
I think that they probably are but I'm going to split hairs about the definition of great, because I think that they are great if you take the word great to mean breadth. They are the most widely spread out successful family, because, you know, I was trying to think, I was racking my brains, like, what other examples are there of dynasties in film? You know, we have, the most it seems to get to is like a son or a daughter becoming an actor or director. So you've got your Jason and your Ivan Reitman. You've got your Tony Curtis and Jamie Lee Curtis. You've got like Tom Hanks and Colin Hanks. But like, the Hankses aren't the Coppolas, because there's still Chet Hanks, the fucking shit white rapper. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, there's like, none of them get that breadth, like spread out across. And also like with people like Wes Anderson, just like, it's like their family has these tendrils that sort of like go into every, become entwined with all these other roots of filmmaking that just means like you end up with your Spike Jonzes and your Wes Anderson, stuff like that. So much so that Wes Anderson, it's almost like an organism that grows its own ecosystem, because then Wes Anderson has his players. So it's almost like there are Coppola connections. And I can even brag about having, like, in the most tenuous way, like Wes Anderson connections, obviously, from working with people who worked with, you know, him on Fantastic Mr. Fox. So I think as a creator of an ecosystem whereby talent can thrive, I mean, I guess you could call them great for sure. I certainly can't think of an example of a family that's had more of an effect. You know, maybe there are in foreign films that we're not aware of that had a massive impact on cinema that we just, that we can't know from our Western lens, you know?
Well, they've got something for everyone, right? Like, so like if they've got the Nick Cages, they've got the Schwartzmans, they've got the Francis Ford Coppola, they've got the Sophias, they've got the Talia Shires. Do you know what I mean? It kind of like, it's almost too much to fathom how kind of wide the web extends.
It's funny you say that, It's funny you say that, because one of my favorite shows that I've just gotten obsessed with recently is Succession on HBO. And Succession is, you know, a proper Faustian bargain drama comedy, but like, you know, with Shakespearean Greek tragic, you know, you know, qualities. And it's all about like the Murdoch family. It's about a news empire and about a mogul whose children are all completely fucked up because he was a monster. And, you know, it's Brian Cox, it's Dr. Guggenheim himself, you know, proving once again that he's fucking amazing. And ironically, that series also begins with him having a stroke. So it's like, you know, the whole thing is about them, you know, fighting over his legacy and fighting over his love. What I think is interesting about Succession is that Succession, you know, when I was thinking about the Coppola family, I was like, actually, when I listened to your first episode where you synopsize what everyone, you know, how everyone's connected, I was like, this doesn't sound a million miles away from like an HBO show, Succession. Mm-hmm. You know, like I would love to see a show like on HBO or somewhere else about a filmmaking dynasty, because I bet that would be really good television. I mean, like, ironically, one of the children in Succession is called Roman. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, I bet you could tell a story about a filmmaker who's made some of the most important movies in the last 50 years, but now might be past his prime, and model him on a Coppola, and then have the other characters be his children and hangers-on and people who are married to his children who are all also trying to become great storytellers in their own right. I bet you could make a great Succession-style show out of that. So yeah, like, I think they're a great family because there's just so much there to mine for entertainment and for insight.
I guess there's probably shades of the Coppola family in Succession. I guess that kind of naming.
I bet they all sit in massively grand dinner tables. You know what I mean? Like, you can't imagine that Francis Ford Coppola doesn't have a huge wooden dinner table.
Yeah.
In some like place with a fireplace and like lots of taxidermy grizzly bears on the wall and shit.
Well, that is entirely why I kind of like have modeled the artwork on this around The Godfather, because it kind of feels like the film that very much speaks to who they are as a family. And you kind of like look to the Corleones, even, yeah, some of them are made up of Coppolas, Talia Shire and Sophia. So like there is that through line. But before we wrap it up, I should ask you, did you find any Coppola connections between this film and others? Did anyone in this film work with the Coppolas anywhere else?
I'm not sure. I know that there's a blink and you miss it cameo by Alexis Bledel in this movie. I know that she's in the public school. So I don't know if she had any connections, but of the actors, I know Bill Murray works with Sofia Coppola. I know that, obviously, Roman Coppola will eventually work with Wes Anderson. I'm not 100% sure. There have been times in my film studies where I've got to confess, confuse Wes Anderson and Spike Jonze for the same person, because they're both like, if they were in Succession, they would be Cousin Greg. They would be that. They're like the fucking they're the fucking Ichabod looking motherfuckers, you know what I mean? They're like weird stringy guys with weird noses, and they're kind of like, you know, quirky and hipstery, and they make these mercurial sort of like indies. But I'm not aware of many other connections besides that.
Well, there's a big argument without the Coppolas, there is no Spike Jonze or Wes Anderson as we know them today, because it's kind of like the Coppolas have given them both their kind of leg up in the industry, whether it's like the kind of
fertile soil with which to plant,
yeah,
you know, their legacies.
The success of Rushmore obviously let Wes Anderson do what he did next, and kind of, if it wasn't for Francis Ford Coppola passing over the script of being John Malkovich to Spike Jonze, then we haven't got Spike Jonze that we know today. But
I'm sure Francis Ford Coppola has been in the position to destroy people's careers. That is a real power.
Yeah.
You know, that is something that I'm sure he must have. I'm sure if he, like, maybe even like further back in time, like there must have been a point where he was utterly untouchable, like The Godfather.
Yeah, but like from doing the research with Francis Ford Coppola, he is very much a guy who, like, he's on the precipice of failure at all times himself. So like, yeah. I don't think he's got much time. Like, I think he's nearly bankrupted the family multiple times for his kind of like endeavors and kind of missteps that he's taken. And
he is a fascinating filmmaker in that way. It's like you said, he has that string of absolute 100% all killer, no filler hits. And if you cut off his career after Apocalypse Now, it doesn't matter what movies he made after that. He's one of the best directors who ever lived. It's weird. It's like weirdly he can actually fail horribly, but he's still the guy who made The Conversation. You know what I mean? It's such a strange thing to be a director of such extremes.
Well, I don't want to talk about it too much, but like his like 80s, some of his like 80s failures, as they were, I love. So I love One from the Heart, like, which is like, for all intents and purposes, a commercial and critical failure.
Well, perhaps this is a good reason why you're doing Coppola Connections for the podcast, because I'm going to listen to these episodes and it might make me track them down. You know what I mean? Like, that's actually nice to shine a little light on some of his lesser known, you know, quote unquote failures.
There are some stinkers in there. Like, let's be honest, at some point, I'm going to have to talk about Jack. Like, or yeah, like I'm gonna have to talk about some of the bad ones, but it's all gonna be part of the fun. Before I let you go, David, let me ask you possibly the most important question of this podcast. What does Bill Murray say to Scarlett Johansson at the end of Lost in Translation?
Permission to be like Max Fischer and be facetious. If Bill had wanted us to hear, he wouldn't have whispered it. So it's not for me to know. I think it's beautiful that I don't know, and I have no interest in guessing. So that's my facetious answer. I demur.
Perfect. Well, David, thank you so much for coming and joining me and being my chapel partner for this episode. Where can people?
It's my pleasure, and I promise your mother did not give me a hand job.
I know my mum. I think she would have done. Jesus. Don't worry. She doesn't listen to this, guys. It's never going to come back to me.
Thank you, Mrs. Petsovers.
Where can people keep up to date with you and everything you're doing?
Well, you know, the funny thing about working in the animation industry is that I have worked on some really cool things that I am not able to show anyone because of non-disclosure agreements. So there's going to come a point in like a year and a half where suddenly my Twitter is going to become filled with like lots of shots and portfolio additions and things. But if you're interested to hear just me talk about films or geek out and basically fangirl over, you know, Caged In and other podcasts in our, you know, circle, then you can find me at drumble on Twitter.
Well, thank you so much, David, for coming and making some Coppola Connections with me.
Mate, it's always a pleasure. Thanks so much for having me. I hope to come back.
Thank you so much for listening. Thank you so much to David Trumble for this fantastic conversation. I'm sure you'll agree, we go to some really like deep and interesting places on this one. And I really, really want to thank David for being so open and honest about this kind of, I don't know, toxic masculine bullshit that we as young men seem to take ownership over women and stuff like that. And it's, I hope that this podcast can be a space to dispel some of that stuff and kind of get it out in the open, that maybe if you are a younger listener, or even if you're older and you're kind of feel disenfranchised and stuff like that by whatever, or kind of feel yourself leaning towards this kind of dodgy incel culture and stuff like that, that people have gone through similar shit, and there is light at the end of the tunnel. So yeah, hold on, like, get some fucking help. there's a lot of good people out there. So yeah, this episode means a lot to me. I kind of like, there's parts of it that kind of made me well up in the edit. So yeah, if you enjoyed this one, please do get in touch. Like, I know I say that every week, but please, this isn't just a shill to now plug the social media, which is Caged In Pod on all social media. So that is Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and Letterboxd. Or if you want to kind of, I don't know, like talk about some of the issues that are raised in this episode a bit deeper, you can always drop me an email, which is cagedinpod@gmail.com. As for next week on the podcast, I am joined by the lovely Matt Brothers, who you may know from Spotlight, Southern Double Deep, and is Paul Dano. Okay, to talk about the 1994 Tim Burton film, Ed Wood. Little fun fact for you, we actually recorded that episode on Tim Burton's birthday, and neither of us figured out until after we'd recorded it. So yeah, that coupled with the fact that I lost the audio for the original version of this episode. Well, my audio. Matt was a consummate professional and kept his audio, so that is there somewhere. But yeah, this episode's been a long time coming, so that it's very good as well. So tune in next week for that. If you enjoyed this podcast, I know I said it at the beginning, but it bears repeating at the end, head on over to patreon.com/cagedinpod to chuck me a little bit of money each month to help me keep the lights on. It really does help. Also, head on over to Apple Podcasts, Acast, or wherever you listen to your podcast and leave a 5-star rating and review. It all really helps in all of the kind of stuff, the visibility on the show. And yeah, would be a I'd love it. I really would. More people listening. It's fun. So as always, I've been Petrus Patsilivas, your guide through the crazy world of the Coppola family tree. So remember to keep it caged in, and I'll catch you next time.